think of your health, man.
Adam Curry, John C. Dvorak.
And Sunday, July 8, 2018, this is your award-winning Gitmo Nation Media Assassination, episode 1049.
This is No Agenda.
With an eye on the prize for a Brexit World Cup and broadcasting live from the capital of the drone star state here in downtown Austin, Tejas, in the Clunio in the morning, everybody. I'm Adam Curry.
And from northern Silicon Valley, where it's really hot, I'm John C. Dvorak.
Crackpot and Buzzkill in the morning.
It's hot everywhere except Texas right now. The UK is burning up. They're going to die.
Well, they're burning up over May's decision to like cave to the EU.
What do you mean?
She's going to give it up. Brexit is going downhill.
They need a do-over. We predicted that immediately, did we not?
Oh, yeah.
They need a do-over. But the Brexit World Cup looks like it's in play.
In play no matter who wins. As long as England beats, who's their next challenger?
Croatia.
Mm-hmm. So England will beat Croatia because there's no money in Croatia getting to the finals.
there's nothing.
There's no money.
By the way, I saw both matches yesterday. I saw England, Sweden, and I thought the Russia-Croatia match, you know, for all of the boringness that is football, I thought it was a damn good show. I liked it.
I liked the double header that went into the net.
Yeah, into the net. We call that a goal?
Yeah, whatever.
Into the net.
So, he got a home run out of it, I think.
Rocking it.
So, I saw the highlights. I'm not going to watch
these matches. It was fantastic. Down to the wire, overtime, pretty good. Penalties. Overtime.
And yeah, here's the question for you. Mm-hmm. Why are these penalty kicks at the end?
Well, if you have a tie score after a 30-minute extension, then and it's in a quarter final, or it's part of the finals.
I know where they show up, but why are they? Who's being penalized? Why are they penalty kicks?
That's okay. You're being literal about everything.
It says penalty. They say penalty kicks. Right. Who they won or the penalty kick. Yeah. Who was the penalty against?
It's against them for taking too long to finish the game.
Uh-huh.
That's why it's... No, it's just a description of where you place the ball, and it's just, you know, one kicker against the goalie. It's just
I know what it is, but why is it called a penalty kick?
Well, why is it a one-hour...
It's stupid.
Why is it one-hour dry cleaning when it takes 2 days?
Well, that's just the name of the place.
Ah, there we go. Exactly. It's just the name of the place. So first I thought, you know, if Russia wins, then we'd have the Novichok World Cup, and there would have been riots.
That would have been great.
I was really rooting for the Ruskies. But they were not. Yeah. Croatia was just better, plain and simple. I thought they were better.
Well, the Russian team was not a good team. It was ranked 70th or something. So Croatia was a better team just by...
Yeah. Just by numbers alone.
Ranking they do.
By numbers alone, exactly.
But so this is going to be a winner no matter what because it's France versus Belgium.
Which would also be...
Either way.
Fun because we have the French-speaking part of Belgium, the Walloons, and we have the Flemish part.
No, but what I'm saying is that no matter who wins that, it's still a Brexit final.
No matter,
don't you think Britain versus France is pretty close to being as good as it gets?
Of course, of course. But they have to be Croatia. It's not a shoe-in yet.
No. Oh, what? Britain beating Croatia?
England has to beat Croatia.
I'll say it again. There's no money.
It does look like this was set up to be a Brexit World Cup final, doesn't it? It just feels that way.
Yeah, I mean, and there's England. No money in Croatia getting to the finals. No one's going to watch. They're going to lose a lot of money. So there's no way they can win that match. This is rigged.
Uh-huh. Well done, though. They need it because the ratings are down dramatically, 48% down, which we can blame on Trump. We can blame it on Trump. Yeah, he's ruined the soccer ratings. Yeah, of course.
It's Trump's fault.
We're way too excited about, you know, kids in cages. All kinds of stuff like this. And,
go on.
Well, I was going to say that Pompeo got back from his high-level meeting in NOCO, the NOCO meeting, and I got one person who had translated the North Korean news agency. Actually, it's the Korean Central News Agency, KNAC, KNAC.KP.
So what was actually said? Because the press had, there was three types of reports. I only have two of them. I have clips from the kind of the objective one that came out of PBS, and then the kind of oddly.
Here's what I found, John. Everybody pointed toward the Associated Press version of the translation, which was really done without context of Koreans in general, North Korea in particular. According to a native North Korean
Let's back up and explain what the controversy is about that you're about to discuss.
So here is the AP, and this is from Matt Lee, our boy Matt Lee. He may actually, I think he travels with Pompeo these days. After talks, N Korea accuses U.S. of, quote, gangster-like demands. And in this letter, which now the Korean Central News Agency website is impossible to navigate, you know, only on one occasion was I actually able to click into their stupid iframe to get the whole English version of the text. And then I couldn't get to it anymore. I just had the first paragraph. But I did read the whole thing. It's quite lengthy. And the translation, from what I understand from native speakers, of robber-like tactics somehow was translated by the Korean Central News Agency as gangster-like tactics, which is very different. But this is also, the way I understand, and I have some standing within the family, this is how North Korea negotiates. Trump says, I'm going to blow you up. You know, that's kind of his way of doing it. My button's bigger than yours, and it works. And the North Koreans go like, oh, you know, you guys suck. You can't. We were ready to go. We want to do all this, all the things you wanted. You were kind of like just wanting all your stuff for yourself. But we love our leaders. They'll fix it. It's all going to be good. That's pretty much the translation the way I think it is in context. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it actually does.
And you know,
well, it sure makes a lot more sense than listening to the left-wing news media going on and on about, oh, it looks like they blew it. They blew it. The
wrong North again, Koreans, Trump.
I knew it. They were suckered.
Wrong again, Trump. I mean, I really want to take it literally, but you know, native North Korean speakers are definitely saying that it's the translation of whatever the term is not gangster-like, but robber-like, and that this is very typical. From unnamed spokespeople in North Korea. This is kind of what they do.
Yeah, well, I don't think we should be too shocked. What do I have here? I've got two clips that kind of wrap this up from the news media's perspective.
Okay.
I've got so many clips, it's ridiculous. There's no reason for
I got two Pompeos here.
Yeah, there you go. Let's go with the NBC version of the it's got some nonsense in it that's just designed to make Trump look like an idiot.
Secretary of State Mike Pompeo is in North Korea tonight, a critical test of whether Kim Jong-un is really ready to give up his weapons. And now reports that President Trump may also be testing Kim's sense of humor by sending him a CD of Elton John's Rocket Man, once Mr. Trump's favorite insult for the North Korean dictator. We get the latest from Chief Foreign Affairs Correspondent Andrea Mitchell.
Secretary of State Pompeo on his third trip to North Korea, his first since the summit.
If I come one more time, I'll have to attack the zip.
And this time maybe bearing gifts. Reports that Pompeo is bringing Kim Jong-un a letter from President Trump and a CD of Elton John's Rocket Man. Pompeo laughing, but no denial. A dramatic turnaround.
Little Rocket Man.
Pompeo's mission nailing down Kim Jong-un's promise to give up his nuclear weapons. After reports, first on NBC News, that intelligence agencies say he is expanding his arsenal, fueling criticism that President Trump was too chummy with Kim.
They said he's too tough. He's going to cause a war. It's too tough. Now they say he's too nice.
All this raising the stakes for Pompeo.
Step number one is a full declaration of your program with an agreement to intrusive verification. If you don't get that, you've got nothing. Period.
The secretary also hoping the North will return the remains of some 200 American soldiers missing since the Korean War, even though the president has said Kim already did that. But none have been returned since trip we covered in 2007, an emotional issue for the sisters of U.S. Army Sergeant Victor Gallerani.
It would mean a great deal to us to know that his remains are discovered and identified and laid to rest on U.S. soil.
The family has a headstone at Arlington, hoping his remains will be returned this time. Andrea Mitchell, NBC News, Washington.
Now, I'm confused about this. The last time we checked this, there have already been multiple remains returned.
That's my understanding.
To the UK as well. Interestingly.
This needs to be further checked.
I mean, there are photos. It doesn't mean anything because it's the internet. And it seems like these are reputable organizations. There's photos of families with, you know, with coffins coming back.
Well, if there's any truth to that, then this report is extremely...
Well, there's more issues with that report.
Yes, there's a lot of issues with the report.
And the big thing is this phony baloney NBC report, which came from that CIA asset who was fired from the LA Times. Everyone keeps reporting, and by the way, if you listen to MSNBC, and I have it on during the day, it's just so much that I forget to clip it, is so much. They keep talking about, intelligence now, you know, the U.S. intelligence says, but they haven't said anything. There's no public statement. It was five unnamed sources, only to NBC, and that is now quoted by everybody as facts. Yeah. And that was, they're expanding.
Which, why are they only quoting to NBC?
Because NBC are the ones who reported this
making
exclusively.
It up.
Yeah. Hey, those guys made it up. We might as well report, which is the best way for intelligence to get information into the system. Is you can always refer to some other quasi-reputable organization such as NBC News. And as long as you can keep doing that, and the same with this gangster thing. Everyone's referring to the AP report. No one has any original reporting on it. And then the Rocket Man thing, my understanding, is when they were meeting, Kim Jong-un said to the president, why did you call me Rocket Man? Is there a joke there? And that's why the CD was sent along.
Oh, I didn't know that, but that makes nothing but sense.
And we know this because this show, 7-8 years ago, came up with a list for my uncle to take to give a bundle of DVDs to Kim Jong-un. You remember that?
Vaguely.
Yeah, we came up with movie titles. Blazing Saddles. We had Blazing Saddles. We had Clear and Present Danger. We had a couple of other classics in there, and some of them I'm quite sure made it into the bundle. I don't know about Blazing Saddles, but
Blazing
but
Saddles.
If you want to understand American humor, which of course has changed since then, but I think that was it.
Yeah, I don't think it's changed that much. Mm-hmm. And I want to say something as we listen to clips today, because I've noticed this with a lot of clips, and I'm starting to see this as a trend. And that clip that you played, that you actually laughed at that little moment where Trump is riding the media for saying he's too tough and he's too soft. He's too tough. He's too soft.
Yeah.
I'm beginning to see this, and you can maybe see it or not see it, or anybody out there can too. The media is doing what it did to get Trump elected.
just reporting on everything with outrage.
Yeah. And when I go to the next series of clips from ABC, which are the Montana speech, they're now covering his speeches. He's been doing these speeches every couple of weeks someplace or other. And they've been going on before he got elected president. He would do these speeches. And we've listened to a couple of them. Mm-hmm. They're about 45 minutes to an hour long. And if you listen to a whole speech, it does have it's stylish entire speech. At the beginning, we talked about this. In early part of 2016, he couldn't do an hour. He was getting about a half an hour done, then repeating himself a lot.
Right.
And you actually went to see a speech.
I did. Yeah.
And these speeches draw a huge audience, and he is working on his material constantly. It's like a comedy act.
He was in rare form in Montana.
I thought so.
He was so jacked up. I mean, he was super hyperkinetic. I can understand why John Kelly's like, oh, man, I got to quit this job. Who can keep up with this monster? He was just bam. I kind of expected him to really mess up. He was so on fire with just his adrenaline. But I think he once again made a very entertaining show. You sit there, Tina and I do this all. We'll watch him talking. And we're like, that's our president. Like, isn't that crazy? And then we're like, you can't help but saying he's pretty entertaining, though. It's better than anything else on TV at that moment.
I have listened to two whole speeches and parts of others. I didn't hear the whole Montana speech. But when you if you listen to him from beginning to end, it's valuable. It's like I don't feel I've wasted my time.
And John, he's 5 years older than you are.
Six
years older than you are.
Think
of the energy you're going to have in 6 years from now. No.
Yeah, I'll be all jacked up.
I don't think so.
Now, here is the PBS report, which is the Pompeo update. And this doesn't have any of the nonsense in it. It's about half the length. In fact, what is the length of this?
28 seconds.
28 seconds. Yeah. And this is the entire report.
Secretary of State Mike Pompeo arrived in North Korea today for more high-level talks aimed at dismantling the country's nuclear weapons program. President Trump left a historic summit last month with a broad commitment from North Korean leader Kim Jong-un to denuclearize. But Pompeo said he hopes to, quote, fill in the details. The Secretary of State will stay overnight in Pyongyang. It is unknown whether he will meet with Kim himself.
Boom.
Well, that is, of course, just before the meeting, though. They didn't have
the press release. I didn't get the second one, but they didn't go on about NBC's intelligence and they're still working. They're digging holes. They're making missiles.
They're grinding nuclear material. Spinning.
But the point is that NBC is really at the bottom of the barrel. ABC must feel a little lax. And so they did this is the five-parter I've got here, which is five short clips. And I want you to take notes, because what this is one of the most, I'd say, egregious series of lies. You know, people are always talking about, again, you are what you say others are, is a classic example in this particular report where John Carl goes off the deep end. And I want you to listen. I've got this cut up in such a way so that you can take notes as we go along. So we can check. We're going to check, fact check them as they go along with their own proofs.
So hold on. I need to get my paper. Hold on. All right. I'm ready.
Okay. This is the intro. With Tom Yamas. This is ABC Montana Report 1.
President Trump is spending the weekend making his final decision on a Supreme Court nominee. At a rally in Montana last night, he told supporters his pick will make them extremely happy. The president's speech there was especially feisty, taking aim at the Me Too movement and a former president's charity while praising Vladimir Putin. Here's ABC's chief White House correspondent, Jonathan Carl.
Okay, now a couple of things. He says he's feisty. He says praises Putin.
Well, it's alliteration, so it's fair game.
Praises Putin. But then he says, I got, you know how many pens I have that don't work? It's unbelievable.
Yeah, you should toss them out.
I do.
And they come back?
Yeah. Huh?
How come socks never do that?
Praises Putin. And then the last one was takes aim at a former president's charity.
Yeah.
Did you hear that?
Did I hear that during the speech?
No, right there. We're just analyzing what they're saying.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, I heard that.
He says, taking aim at a former president's charity.
Yes.
That's what he said.
Yes.
So we now have to assume.
The Clinton Foundation.
That there's a charity. No. No. That's not the Clinton Foundation. But we have to assume that a charity is somehow involved in what's to follow. Let's go to clip two.
It was the most unusual speech for a president of the United States. First, lavishing praise on an American adversary.
You know, President Putin is KGB and this and that.
How is that,
you know,
praise?
What? Putin's fine. He's fine. We're all fine.
And for most of the rest of the speech, lashing out at just about everybody else.
Okay. Yes, I heard a fact check false in that one.
Fact check false?
That was not praise.
He says lavish, not just praising, lavishing praise.
Lavishing praise.
Which is what the viewer would say. Oh, he's lavishing praise. He's lavishing praise. And then they cut to a clip where all Trump says is that Putin's fine.
Yeah.
And if we remember George Carlin's old bit about the word fine, which I would like to have.
Ooh, I don't know this this bit.
Oh,
do
yeah,
I know
he goes
this?
On and on. He says, "I'm fine." It's the stupidest thing you can say to somebody. I'm fine.
I gotta find this.
Anything.
I gotta find this.
He goes on and on about how "I'm fine" is like an insult. So whatever, however you look at it, from the George Carlin perspective or from a normal person's perspective, what we heard was nothing. It was not lavishing praise.
No, certainly not.
And then he cuts to, now he starts lashing out. And by the way, he starts this premise, and they're at the beginning of the short clip. He says, it's one of the most unusual things a president has ever done. He does this exact same speech.
Every time.
Constantly.
Yeah.
And apparently, John Carl's never been to one.
Hmm.
That's what I'm thinking, because he's never seen anything like it in his life, because nobody has.
I don't even know who John Carl is, so.
Oh, if you saw his face, you can look him up and look at his face. Oh, yeah, I've seen this guy. He's a correspondent for ABC. He's been there forever.
Hmm.
And he apparently hates Trump. So anyway, so now he says he's lashing out. So we're going to hear lashing out after heaping praise. Well, we're going to hear lashing out.
I better brace myself. If he's lashing out, it could. I don't want it to hit me in the face.
And for most of the rest of the speech, lashing out at just about everybody else. Even 94-year-old former Republican President George H.W. Bush and his slogan meant to promote volunteerism.
1,000 points of light. I never quite got that one. Try to say, what the hell is that?
And just days before he travels to Europe to meet with America's NATO allies, this.
I'll see NATO and I'm going to tell NATO, you got to start paying your bills. We're the schmucks that are paying for the whole thing.
Yeah, yeah, it's quite exaggerated.
Where's the lashing out?
And the 1,000 points of light was not a charity.
As it was introduced in the opening of the segment by... Yamas, he says it's a charity. There's no charity here.
No, that was.
This is some of the worst. This is, by the way, I can do this daily. This is classic mainstream media, and they talk about Trump being a liar again. I am what I say you are. I love that phrase.
Wat je zegt ben jezelf met je kop door de helft.
Is these guys? And this is, and where's the lashing out? He just says he's lashing out at himself because we're the schmucks paying for NATO.
Yeah.
Okay, so we go on. So it doesn't end there.
No. Why did I not expect it to end?
Clip 4.
And the president added a new twist to his attack on a familiar target, Senator Elizabeth Warren, who once claimed.
New target?
New twist on an old target.
Oh, I'm sorry. I misunderstood.
And the president added a new twist to his attack on a familiar target, Senator Elizabeth Warren, who once claimed, without proof, to have Native American heritage.
Let's say I'm debating Pocahontas, right? I promise you I'll do this. I will take, you know those little kits they sell on television for $2? Learn your heritage.
And then he compounded his attack on Senator Warren by mocking the Me Too movement.
We will take that little kit and say, but we have to do it gently. Because we're in the Me Too generation, so we have to be very gentle. And we will very gently take that kit and we will slowly toss it, hoping it doesn't hit her and injure her arm.
Yeah. Okay. First, I want to say, when I saw him say this, I'm like, $2? These things are $90 or $60. He has zero idea what these things cost. The DNA
kits. Well, I don't
know
whether he has an idea or not. But
I'm just saying, I thought that was very odd.
Well, he was just demeaning it by using that number.
Gotcha.
Like, it's just a cheap piece of crap as far as he's concerned.
Right.
But... this will be, he'll be called out because this is a blatant lie, which is exactly what you just said.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Of course. He didn't mock the Me Too movement. He was talking about the Me Too generation. That's very different.
By mocking the Me Too movement, or by saying he mocks the Me Too movement, that NBC report reflects the exact wordage.
Yeah.
That you could find in Salon and Alternet.
Yeah, but
I was looking around in that. I was just checking this out. And Alternet is the one who promoted mocking the Me Too movement. This is a left-wing operation that hates Trump.
Yes.
And is that where ABC's getting its stuff?
No, the more I see this take place, the more I realize that people are just denying what they're hearing. This is part of the dimensional issue on both sides, but of course the media is what we see most of the time. And they the words come in and they just translate different in their brain. It's the same. It's part of the no nations or no borders versus open borders. They can read the words, yet it translates to something else in their head. I have no other explanation for it. You think that they're
I'm sure that John Carl is not just an incompetent liar.
Exactly.
But if you break it down like what I'm doing, it sounds like he is.
Yeah.
So, but yeah, you're probably. I mean, that's exactly. They're hearing Trump saying, you know, talking.
Look, if your brain is looking for outrage, you're going to find it. And the minute you hear, oh, because I have a capability to straddle. When I heard him say that, I'm like, oh, this is going to be a problem. Because, you know, this is messing with the Me Too movement. And
no, I will say.
And you know, I was going to say that only when I really went back and listened, even me, a second time, they said, oh, he said Me Too generation. That's very specifically different. And by the way, Obama was the king of doing this, making you think something. You could catch him on the words and you went back and, oh, shit, he said it exactly that way. Obama was very good at this, too.
But again, I'm going to point out that the stuff that they're playing because they're outraged is actually appealing to, I think, a large part of the population. And I think they're starting to bring up the Republican voter. They're going to, if these guys keep this up, if they don't just shut up about Trump, they're not going to get anywhere in this expected, takeover of the House and Senate.
Yeah, I think that's a very good point. It's the same formula they're applying, and now it's fueled even more by the Rob Reiners of the world who desperately want the platform to continue to do it, which is exactly counteractive to their mission.
Yeah, it's self-defeating. Yeah,
that's a good point. That's an outstanding point.
And you are going to see more and more of it as we listen to these clips, because they're going to play clips that are kind of interesting. I listened to that last clip about tossing the $2 kit over to her very gently so it doesn't hurt her, mm-hmm. as a kind of a amusing. And
it was I'm sad they no one seemed to want to play the whole gag, because the whole gag right up to the Trump will give you $1 million if you take the test. The whole bit was funny.
Yeah.
And the crowd loved it. It was a funny bit. But now they had to chop it off and then pull it out of context and pull out the Me Too thing. It was too bad, because they could have actually done better for themselves.
They're not going to do it. Okay, so let's wrap it with the clip 5.
Warren hit back on Twitter. Hey, Donald Trump, while you obsess over my genes, your administration is conducting DNA tests on little kids because you ripped them from their mamas and you are too incompetent to reunite them.
And the president with a big weekend ahead at his Bedminster estate, getting down to the wire on that Supreme Court decision, John.
He's going to be having dinner tonight, Tom, with Vice President Pence out there at Bedminster, certainly talking about his pick that I am told he will make over the weekend. He's also going to be taking calls from key outside advisors and key members of the Senate. But, Tom, the big announcement will come prime time on Monday. And this White House, if it was like last time, will want it to be a surprise when the president walks in with his pick for the Supreme Court.
But we'll still monitor all the tweets and everything he says over the weekend. All right, Jonathan, thanks so much.
Oh, I'm glad someone's doing that. Monitor those tweets, boss. It's good.
Monitor the tweets.
Now, how did he start off? There was something funny about the start of that clip. What did he say at the beginning there?
Oh, I don't remember.
Warren hit back.
Oh, yeah, about Warren.
Warren, she hit back.
This is one that, you know, I think we talked about in the last show where, you know, everyone's all DNA is great. DNA is fantastic. You know, CSI, we believe it. The jury pool's been corrupted by the belief in DNA. Now we have rapid DNA. It's been great. It's gotten people out of jail who were there for years who didn't believe it. What? You want to check children's DNA if they belong to the people who are there with you? You ogre. You rip the children. You take their DNA. If you believe in rapid DNA, and we've been led to believe it does work through producers who are involved in the field.
In the business.
In the biz. That's fantastic. You can save a child from being trafficked.
The Democrats do not want to talk about the trafficking issue.
No, clearly they don't. Clearly they don't. Well, I think what we're seeing, there's this no borders, open borders.
I think I have the no borders, no nations. This is something you can use anytime you want.
Is this like an ISO type thing?
Stop deportation, no borders, no nations. Stop deportation, no borders, no nations. Stop deportation, no borders, no nations. Stop deportation.
There was a,
it's usable by everybody.
It's very, very usable, highly usable. I have a couple of funny clips about the kids in cages stuff, which still kind of continues. I think we're kind of interested, though we're already on to other things in this new rotation. This is this was a fun report.
This story's just in. A federal judge has agreed to delay a meeting about extending her court-ordered deadline to reunite 100 children under the age of five with their parents. She reportedly granted the extension because a Trump administration lawyer has dog-sitting responsibilities this weekend. The Trump administration had already asked the judge for more time to reunite the families. The judge's earlier court ruling said all children under five must be reunited by this coming Tuesday and all other minors by July 26th.
Now, I don't know why he said minors. I think he's confused. He meant minors. There you go, minors. But seriously?
He said minors?
Yeah, minors. Yeah, I got it now. Seriously? You know, we had to delay it because I have dog sitting duties. This is my, this is universes colliding, baby.
Hey, hey, dogs, man. Dogs. People too. Dogs are people too.
People too, man. I don't care what you say. It's just the fact.
Dogs are people too. The dog sitting prioritizes over kids.
Well, yeah, they're so cute.
Dogs are people too.
I was in the supermarket. And there was a dog walker with a dog from my building. And I know because it's a collie that looks like a collie, a cross between a collie and a Dalmatian. Because it's white and black spots. Very, very pretty dog.
On a collie?
Yeah, very pretty dog.
They should breed that dog.
And he's got two kind of different color yellow eyes. And he recognized me. I looked at him like, hey, I know. He went, you're the guy with the zapper.
You're the guy with the what?
The dog dazer, the zapper.
Oh, you're the guy with that whistle.
He looked at me like, I know who you are. Make that sound again, because you know I'm not going to bark from it. Yeah. Let's see, what else did I pick? Oh, yeah, so then there was another story which didn't really get legs. I think that it's still being used now, you know, as a truth, as a fact, that Trump is throwing immigrants out of the military. He's so horrible. He's purging. He's getting rid of them.
Purging's a good word. They don't use it enough.
Well, they should.
Because that refers to Stalin.
And it turns out that's, you know, the Pentagon's like, ho, hold on a second.
This is bull crap.
This military recruiting program, which provided a fast track to American citizenship, was set up after 9/11 by President Bush when the military needed immigrants with certain special language skills, especially after the surge into Iraq and Afghanistan. It was known by its acronym, MAVNI. Since then, 110,000 immigrants hoping to serve in the U.S. military have become naturalized citizens through the program, which was suspended last September amidst concerns that the Defense Department could not properly vet those who were volunteering for basic training with the promise of fast-track citizenship. The AP story entitled U.S. Army Quietly Discharging Immigrant Recruits quotes a retired U.S. Army colonel who helped set up the program. She has since become an immigration lawyer and says that about 40 recruits who were hoping to obtain naturalization had been abruptly dismissed. A senior U.S. defense official tells Fox that, in fact, there is no new policy when it comes to these recruits, but that the 40 in question had issues with their security clearances. Fox has learned that most of those in question were from China, Pakistan, and Iran. These were the hardest cases, one U.S. official told Fox. According to statistics provided by the U.S. military, 5,000 immigrants were recruited into the program in 2016. And though it is currently suspended, there are 10,000 currently serving. A statement from the U.S. Army explains why some have recently been discharged. Quote, any recruit who receives an unfavorable security screening is deemed unsuitable for military service and is administratively discharged. Bottom line, Dana, if you can't pass the background check, you are not getting into the U.S. military. Both Republicans and Democrats on the Armed Services Committees have expressed concerns in the past about the program, which is currently under review by the Defense Department.
Well, there you go. And
well, that's a lot different than the stories that they're promoting.
Yeah, well, it also there's no
there's purging them left and right. They're just pulling them out.
And there's no Mexicans they're purging from the military. And by the way, the number one group of illegal immigrants in the United States are Chinese, which I didn't know.
Well, if you live around here, it wouldn't surprise you.
I've flown around there, believe me. I don't like flying in the California airspace. You cannot understand the other pilots, especially the students on the weekend.
Mm.
Yeah, it's just bad. For a close, oh yeah, there was one more. This is another meme that it's. I don't exactly know who's trying to pull this one about Anne Frank. Oh, you know, Anne Frank tried to immigrate to the U.S. but was denied, and look what happened to her.
I don't believe that.
No, it's complete bull crap. You know, she had papers at the Rotterdam embassy, which Rotterdam was blown up, including all her papers or her dad's papers. But that's kind of, you know, it's just another tie it into Hitler, Holocaust, do whatever you want to do. And I think, well, I wanted to play a couple of clips here because this goes to the, you really opened up my eyes and ears with the difference between no borders and open borders, or I should say open borders and no borders, because it's clearly two different things. And I'm pretty sure there's also two different groups doing this. And you called it a plague or a virus or something, and you may be right. First, I think we need to look. I have a little background here. This is the rise of the New York City Democratic Socialists of America. This is the group that... what's her name? Ocasio-Cortez. Her name is too long. Everyone's struggling with this in the media because it has to be...
I just use AOC.
Hey, I think AOC, or let's just call her... What's her name? Alexandria? Yeah. Okay.
I can't remember. I can remember the cast. You know, the...
AOC. Oh, AOC from now on.
Bernie Sanders helped put them on the map, but now the group seems to be on everyone's lips here in the city.
You were endorsed by a group, the Democratic Socialists.
The Democratic Socialist New York City chapter was instrumental in Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez's upset win, providing hundreds of volunteers to canvass for her. Now many observers are asking what exactly democratic socialism means.
The definition of democratic socialism to me, again, is the fact that in a modern, moral, and wealthy society, no American should be too poor to live.
The group's priorities include issues like universal health care, labor rights, and in recent weeks, the movement to abolish U.S. Customs and Immigration Enforcement, known as ICE. It's an activist group rather than a political party, and it's very picky in choosing candidates to get behind.
When we endorse someone, we don't just do a paper endorsement, we send an army.
That army is holding its fire in some of this year's hotly contested state primaries. The group is not endorsing any of the progressive challengers to former members of the Independent Democratic Conference, or IDC, which helped keep Republicans in power in the state Senate. And it has yet to decide whether to back candidate for Governor Cynthia Nixon. For now, its only endorsed candidate is Julia Salazar, who is trying to unseat longtime Brooklyn State Senator Martin DeLon.
It's an incumbent who takes a huge amount of money from real estate interests, has been in power for decades, is sort of an ossified creature of the old Democratic machine.
Ocasio-Cortez's victory bodes well for Salazar, who's seen a spike in fundraising since last week.
Now, before I go to my next clip in the no open borders versus no borders, you did a little deconstruction of the candidates in New York, the female candidates in New York in the newsletter. You want to talk about that? Since it's-
No. Those are the – I did a deconstruction of the five women that have been isolated as those that are acceptable by the Democratic Party to run for president.
Okay. Gotcha. Who was this Jamoke then, this woman? Salazar?
I don't know.
Mm. Well, she's also part of the DSA, which I didn't even know was a thing. And, you know, they've been endorsed by Bernie Sanders, but when you talk to Bernie Sanders, he not only, he doesn't speak of no borders, he speaks of open borders, but he has a completely different take on that. Whereas I would think you have the, you've got Democrats who want no borders, I mean, open borders, and you have the Democratic Socialists who want open borders. Does that make sense?
I'm not going to totally agree with that.
Well, Bernie Sanders doesn't agree either. Listen to this.
Something that is in what you said about being a democratic socialist is a more international view. But I think if you take global poverty that seriously, it leads you to conclusions that in the U.S. are considered out of political bounds. Things like sharply raising the level of immigration we permit, even up to a level of open borders, about sharply increasing
open
the
borders.
Foreign aid. Open borders.
That's a Koch brothers proposal. The idea, of course. I mean, that's a right-wing proposal, which says essentially there is no United States.
But it would make a lot of global poor richer, wouldn't it?
And it'd make everybody in America poor. Then you're doing away with the concept of a nation state. And I don't think there's any country in the world which believes in that. If you believe in a nation state or in a country called the United States or UK or Denmark or any other country, you have an obligation, in my view, to do everything we can to help poor people. What right-wing people in this country would love is an open border policy.
So he says it's a right-wing policy.
Okay, well, here's what I can get out of this. What he is saying is that what he is referring to is the globalist overall concept of no borders.
Right.
The same way Hillary Clinton said she would dream of a day in the future where there would be no borders from the tip of South America to the top of Canada, no borders anywhere. There's no borders. And that kind of feeds into the globalist idea where there's one world government. You don't need borders if there's one world government. The whole thing, you know, referring to the EU's experiment, which has no borders, supposedly. Uh-huh. And so you can blame that on the right wing. But the most recent – I looked into – by the way, I'm trying to find the origin of these people that are with these no borders, no this, no that. And it seems to stem from European anarchists.
Hmm.
And so the whole no borders thing really comes out of Europe. A lot of it comes out of the UK. Because the anarchists there are the ones that they're the remainers.
Yes.
They want to stay in the EU they have all these issues. And they're the ones.
they have issues.
There's a lot of noise. They make a lot of noise and they kind of spread through the IWW into the United States and the World Workers' Party, I believe, even though I haven't been able to isolate that so much. And so this is alien. These guys who are sitting in at the ICE building here in San Francisco, and they have these crazy ideas, and they blather out all kinds of weird stuff that's extremely Marxist. It's really an anarchist movement from Europe.
They're agents provocateurs.
I don't think they think they are.
It doesn't matter what they think. Clearly, the Democratic Party, after Hillary Clinton lost, fell apart, and a vacuum was created. And these fuckers got sucked up into it. And the media is so filled with hatred of everything Republican, everything Trump, that they're actually propagating the message and making it sound like a good thing while even using the incorrect terms.
I know.
And it is. Yeah. It's a virus and it's spreading. And people are really into this. And smart people, John, who just don't even think about the implication. And then the Bernie Sanders blames it on the Koch brothers is hilarious. We have a producer working at one of the Koch brothers charities. He'll tell me if that's their mission. I doubt it. But he's saying, they just want cheap workers. Yeah, that's for sure.
Well, that's for sure.
Absolutely. But this also leads in. Well, so let's just stay with one other point, which you and I promise each other to bring up on the show. I'm actually doing it. Something we discussed not on the air. And that was AOC's campaign promise of a job guarantee.
Yeah.
And this is not just a, everyone should have work or anything like that or minimum wage. This is an actual economic policy that I don't think has it ever been tried?
I don't think so. It's all theory.
Yeah. You can look it up in the book of knowledge.
This has been glossed over. There's two things about AOC that's been glossed over. One, in fact, I would like to play the Chuck Todd interview with her because I want to point out the main thing, the elephant in the room that Chuckster didn't bring up. And it's a very softball kind of interview. He's got her in the studio for Face the Nation or Meet the Press. He does Meet the Press. And then I can we can discuss a little bit this jobs guarantee, you know, job guarantee idea.
What do you think it's called, that clip? Because I can't.
AOC
find.
Rambling with Chuck Todd.
Yeah, I got it.
The timeline in which our civil rights could potentially be further eroded.
Let me talk about some of your policy positions, but generally, which is, first explain this to me. You were endorsed by a group, the Democratic Socialists, and you have embraced this label. And I think the New York Times has a headline this morning, the sort of millennials have embraced
this.
Socialism. What is your definition of Democratic Socialists?
Well, for me, again, and there's so much focus on this endorsement, but I also think it's important that an important part of my strategy in winning was building a broad-based coalition of people. So while there's a focus on this one aspect of the coalition, and to me, you know, to answer your question, the definition of democratic socialism to me, again, is the fact that in a modern, moral, and wealthy society, no American should be too poor to live. And to me, that means every working-class American in this country should have access to dignified health care, should actually be able to see a doctor without going broke. It means you should be able to send your kids to college and trade school if they so choose. And no person should feel precarious or unstable in their access to housing as our economy develops.
Some Democrats are afraid of the S word. They feel like that social weakness, it has... Older Americans hear socialism and they tie it to sort of ugly governments from Europe and the past.
Yes.
How do you sell this to an older generation?
Well, I think as the clip from Schumer showed earlier, Democrats are a big tent party. You know, I'm not trying to impose an ideology on all, you know, several hundred members of Congress. But I do think that, once again, it's not about selling an ism or an ideology or a label or a color. This is about selling our values.
Are you a democratic socialist? Is that what you call yourself, or you don't want that label?
I mean, it's part of what I am. It's not all of what I am. And I think that that's the very important distinction. Uh-huh. I'm an educator. I'm an organizer. And I believe that what we're really seeing is just a movement for healthcare, housing, and education in the United States.
All right. You defeated a potential future speaker. Should Nancy Pelosi be that next Speaker of the House, or should be a new generation?
You know, once again, I want to see the options on the table. First of all, I'm not even an elected member of Congress yet. Secondly, we need to see what is going on. I think that it's just premature for me to commit to any kind of decision on this. I was just elected on Tuesday, Chuck.
Fair enough. I'm going to leave it there.
Let me read you this.
She's, by the way, at the end, she says, I was just elected. She was nominated. She was nominated to run.
Nice.
But she says she was elected.
She's already elected. She's already in D.C. How come she isn't with those kids in Thailand? That's where you should be.
Surprised she's not there. She's already gone to the border in Mexico, in either Arizona or California.
Exactly. Yeah. Let me read this. The Wikipedia actually has a pretty good definition of this job guarantee program.
And the thing, don't go on. I want to mention the things that Chuck Todd failed to talk about, even though he's grilling her about being a socialist. One is besides the jobs guarantee thing, which we'll get into, because nobody talks about that. So I'll give him a pass on that. But he never mentions that she wants to shut down ICE.
Well,
Pence might think it's top of
the news. He could have done that.
I don't know why he didn't.
He was,
because I like to get her in that. You know, there's a bunch of these politicians. I would say Elizabeth Warren is one of them. And I think, what's her name? Gillihan, Gilligan's Island. What's her name?
Gillibrand.
Gillibrand.
Gillibrand's Island.
She's one of them. And they need to be called out for this, because it's pretty... it's pretty ludicrous if you listen. Well, at least it seems ludicrous if you listen to the Pence speech, which was very interesting.
I think with Chuck Todd, you know, once he heard I'm an educator and I'm an organizer, he was like, oh, I'm done. That's my new president. I feel good. I'm warm and fuzzy. That's Obama 2.0 right there. I'm an educator. I'm an organizer. Kinda. All right. Here's this jobs guarantee. Oh. This economic theory that she...
Right. I just want to preface it by telling people you'll hear this a lot. Oh, jobs guarantee, and it just seems like, oh, they want everyone to have a job. Yeah, well, that's great, because everybody wants no unemployment and all the rest. But no. This is an economic theory.
Yeah,
that is alien to everything you've ever known.
The economic policy stance currently dominant around the world uses unemployment as a policy tool to control inflation. When cost pressures rise, the standard monetary policy carried out by the monetary authority, that would be your central bank or the Fed, tightens interest rates, creating a buffer stock of unemployed people, which reduces wage demands and ultimately inflation. When inflationary expectations subside, these people will get their jobs back. Okay, so that's the, I guess you'd call it the Keynesian system, maybe? Maybe not?
That's the way it works today, yeah.
In Marxian terms, that would be AOC, according to Wikipedia, the unemployed serve as a reserve army of labor. And by contrast, in a job guarantee program, a buffer stock of employed people employed in the job guarantee program provides the same protection against inflation without the social cost of unemployment, hence potentially fulfilling the dual mandate of full employment and price stability. Now, so what they're saying here is people get screwed when we go through these boom and bust cycles and they lose their job, but then they get them back, which is, you know, due to central bank intervention, which that sounds about right. You know, it's kind of a whipsaw and it's annoying if you're out of a job. But what they're saying is employ everybody and you can, you know, you'll have the people to work when you have the work. It's just they won't be out of a job, which somehow this magic money came into a play somewhere to pay everybody.
They're not going to ever do this because of a number of reasons, ironically, unions being one of them.
Yeah.
But Obama kind of did stuff like this during his early years when he had extended unemployment benefits for years. Some people were on unemployment forever.
Mm-hmm.
And this is kind of like the jobs guarantee theory.
Well, Obama took
it. In other words, you keep these people.
Obama took it a step further. He had.
Everybody in Cleveland, low minority, got Obama phone. Keep Obama in president, you know? He gave us a phone.
Remember? The Obama phone?
The Obama phone.
Classic.
Yeah.
A classic.
Anyway, if you read the Wikipedia entry, it's pretty good. Look up jobs guarantee.
It's very good. Yeah.
And they have all the economists listed who subscribe to the idea as an experiment. And instead of toying with the interest rates the way we do now to play with inflation, you would toy with this pool of workers that are working for the government that come in and out of private sectors. It reminds me a little bit of that executive services branch of the government, which is kind of a jobs program for these are the guys who fill the roles of various agencies. So when a new president comes in and they get rid of a bunch of people,
right?
These jokers, they're professionals. They come all in to work these jobs, and then they go back and forth. It's kind of the modeling is very similar. But that's what they're talking about. Nobody that I know of has ever discussed this on the mainstream media. They just
accept it for the words that they think it means and didn't even look into it.
That means it just – and not only that, but I think from the Democrat perspective or the mainstream media perspective that promotes Democrat policies, I think it makes you look silly to say something like jobs guarantee, because the normal person would step back and go, that doesn't make any sense. You can't guarantee somebody a job. You'd have to explain the whole thesis for it to make any sense whatsoever. So I think they're hurting their cause by just throwing it out there without explanation.
We have an entire generation of children growing up who have expectations that have been set so poorly by their parents that there's no disappointments. That's part of the everyone wins. Everyone gets a trophy. You know, you need disappointments, you need bad times to live a full life and to understand what it's like to, you know, to feel free and to feel good. You have to, if you have no measurement. So to these kids who are like, well, you can't hurt my feelings. You can't, you know, say anything bad about somebody else that might hurt my feelings. They deserve a job.
I think that's probably some of the thinking. A lot of them have been corrupted by and I'll again blame Obama for this, the student debt crisis.
Oh, my goodness. She wants to forgive all student debt. You know, I'm reading these student loans, and I had one of these. There was a certain point, and I bought, now we're talking in the late 80s, I think, maybe just around 90. I bought an Apple PowerBook Color. It was like $4,000. It was some outrageous amount of money. And I really, this is MTV days, and I really, you know, $4,000 is a lot of money on the MTV salary. And I remember getting it with some, you know, through some company in PC Magazine, probably, or Mac User or whatever. And I had, you know, I had this loan I paid off, I don't know, $300 a month. And then years later, someone was, you know, helping me clean up my admin. I said, I need that from time to time. And he said, holy shit, you still owe like $3,800 on this laptop, but you've paid over $4,000. And that's the kind of loans these kids are getting suckered into, where you're paying principal only.
No, interest only.
Interest only. I mean, wasn't Elizabeth Warren supposed to stop that? Wasn't that her
Elizabeth
job?
Warren, again, is a big, she talks a big game. She does nothing that I can see. She's done nothing. She's supposed to talk to call the robocalls from Rachel. I still get them from Rachel. They didn't even change the name of the woman.
Exactly. But you know, that's something that that's something that needs to be addressed. I mean, it's one thing for these kids to have student debt, and exorbitant student debt, but then for, you know, the payoff to be pretty much interest only is that's crazy. You're screwing a whole generation, literally turning them into slaves, slave wages. And
this is a problem.
Something has to, you know,
and this would really be really took off during the Obama administration. I don't think it should have been excoriated for this. No. This guy gets more of a pass than Clinton.
Yeah. Although Trump is doing all kinds of interesting things, this has not been reported very widely. You remember the threat corridor from Obamacare, or the threat corridor? It was the debt corridor. I'm sorry. Well, the insurance companies, they demanded from, and that's why there was such a problem passing Obamacare, but it did eventually pass, where the insurance company said, okay, part of the Affordable Care Act, this is good. What we're going to do is we will make sure we insure everybody, but we have to have payments from the government to offset the losses we're going to have on, and you know, by the way, we'll jack up rates too, but we still will have losses, so you have to pay for that. And these payments, I think, come quarterly, and the most recent payment, which is $10 billion, the Trump administration has stopped. They said, we're not paying anybody because a judge in, let me see, where's this judge? Some judge took a look at the calculator. There's a calculation that they make every quarter to see how much threat payments they have to get. Apparently, this thing is all jacked, and they've been, you know, the way it's distributed and who's getting the money is, you know, it's the risk adjustments are all off, and so they're being way overpaid. And so he's stopping this, which I think is incredibly smart, because while no one is looking, everyone's looking at kids in cages, Trump, I believe, has put in policy that insurance companies now can work cross state lines, so they can sell, there's more competition in general. But now they're going to change this calculator. They're going to let new, younger, fresh companies into the market, which should, I really do think, I'm no economist. I can't even do a laptop payment properly. But I think it will lower rates.
Well, the funny thing about this is that this has been talked about, the cross-state lines, buying and selling, incessantly.
For decades.
From, you know, Bush through Obama. And nobody would do anything about it. They just talk about it. This is like Elizabeth Warren. You know, she's a big talker. She talks about this and that. What needs to be done? Yeah. And she does nothing. She doesn't introduce legislation. She doesn't push anything through. She doesn't try to find allies who could get some of these things passed. She doesn't care. She just likes to do. And that's on that list that I put in the newsletter of all these candidates. That was one of her flaws. I called her do nothing because she's a do nothing type.
Right.
And this is, but I think most of the Republicans are too. It's unbelievable. And so Trump comes in and apparently this gets done and nobody wants to even mention
it. No, it's like one article in the New York Times. That's about it.
Yeah.
I like it. I think that's good. The hatred, though, for Trump, and also as a part of no nations, no borders, no profit, no prisons. Yeah, no prisons. That's also get rid of prisons. No ICE, obviously. This has now taken on this propaganda has taken on a whole new twist. This is a recording of the Chicago Police Department. It's from a scanner recording just the other night. And then this happened.
1772. 72. 14 hour, free at dinner. Leland and Kedzie. Have four, enjoy. But much for the Elend. Trotz der zwingenden Großartigkeit dieser Herrschau unserer Partei. Sich bemühen.
Units, watch your keys. Units, watch your keys.
So what you're hearing is him saying, watch your keys. Someone's microphone is keyed open. But nothing could be further from the truth. It's someone breaking in on the frequency and playing a Hitler speech. Yeah, listen, here it comes again. He just kept on going. Like 20 minutes, it just kept going.
Have an emergency. Switch to a citywide.
This is obviously a problem if the cops are trying to communicate. That's what we've come to now, is let's interrupt the cops and treat them like they're Nazis and play their fearless leaders' tapes to them. That's the only explanation I have for this kind of gag.
Yeah, no, that's exactly what it is. They're sitting there, some kids, I'm guessing, who have no knowledge of FCC law or anything else, but they have somehow got a hold of a transmitter that could be tuned to the cops' frequencies, and somebody knew how to do that. And they started feeding that stuff in there.
I'm curious if
they could catch those.
Now, I'm curious if does Chicago not have a digital system? It doesn't sound like it. But digital system is encrypted and much harder to do. I'm surprised Chicago doesn't have that. Because, you know, any county or any district that has a regular RF, this may become a problem if this is, this is fun, let's do this the whole time.
Yeah, hey, could be.
You know what's going to happen then?
What?
Well, the ham radio guys are going to have to come in.
Oh, yeah, the ham radio guys can triangulate this character.
When the apocalypse comes, we're the guys who are going to save the world, right?
Right? We're going to have to, John. We will have to save the world.
Yeah.
All right. Knock, knock.
Who's there?
Hugo.
Hugo who?
Hugo Podcasting!
Oh, you said Hugo. I heard Hugo.
And with that, I'd like to thank you for your courage and say in the morning to you, John C., where the C stands for Cortacio Dvorak.
Well, in the morning to you, Mr. Adam Curry. Also in the morning to all the ships at sea out there. We have boots on the ground, feet in the air.
Subs in the water.
Indeed, in the morning.
The tonight,
yes, indeed. In the morning to everyone in the troll room, noagendastream.com, where you can listen to the show live every single Sunday and Thursday morning. And we always appreciate the feedback we get from the trolls in the troll room. Also in the morning to Nick the Rat. He brought us the artwork for episode 1048. The title of that was Crush Ice. And this was, we had a lot of different art to choose from. There was a beautiful hockey puck, was it the hockey puck one?
Yes, the hockey puck. And I want to tell that I forgot who the artist was with the hockey puck, but it looked fine on my screen, but it pixelated on Adam's screen because it was done in too low a resolution. And used pixelated ones before that I assured him would be fine, and none of them were.
And then people get angry and like, you suck. Anyway, this was a... it wasn't an odd image of Kathy Griffin as an alien, but it was so well done. It just fit. You know, you don't have to do much, actually. Just add some antennae with eyes on them, and there you go. add a little starry background. The rest is all Kathy. No color correction needed. And we thank you, Nick the Rat, for doing that for us. One more, and I think he's got the hat trick, which is not a first. I believe Nick has had a hat trick before, hasn't he?
Him and Martin JJ both had numerous ones.
And I believe Comic Strip Blogger has had a hat trick.
Maybe.
Yeah. NoAgendaArtGenerator.com is where you can contribute your value to the program. We really appreciate that. And everyone who submits, we use it for all kinds of stuff. Thank you again. And let's thank some of our executive and associate executive producers.
Yes. Starting off with Sir Dr. Sharkey, $333.34, Jackson, Tennessee. He sent in a note, which I have. You know, that's what I needed. I don't have my reading glasses. No, I can read it. Uh-huh. Please forgive my length, thanks to the new eyeball. Please forgive my lengthy absence. My growing human resource has distracted me from what is truly important in life. Propagating the formula.
Don't you forget it.
Please dedouche me.
Yeah. Okay, hold on. I didn't have the dedoucher ready.
You've been dedouched.
Also, feel free to apply the extra 0.01, the penny, for my donation to any needy member of the realm.
All right. Will do. Thank you.
Sincerely, Dr. Sharkey.
Thank you.
Okay. Sir Wasteless, Lost Baronet of Timber Hill, Electra, Texas, $333.33. Sir Wasteless, as having no visible waste. Lost Baronet of Timber Hill here. I just unloaded an underperforming property, so here's my tribute. No jingles, no karma, but please send a round of chilled Polish potato vodka round the table.
Chilled Polish potato vodka. I'm putting it on the list right now. Okay.
Yeah. So a lot of Polish vodka. Or if you actually did this right, it's vodka.
Vodka, yes.
However, I need to ask Adam.
Yeah.
I do need to ask Adam a question. Some time ago, he has mentioned mail server software that he's using. In a few words, could Adam refresh our collective memory?
Ah, yes. I've been running my own mail server for years. And you need a Linux box. It's all standard stuff, but there's this installer, I'll just call it that, which is quite user-friendly. It's called iReadMail. As in iPhone, iReadMail, R-E-D-M-A-I-L, iReadMail. And that'll get you going. Just follow the instructions. If a VJ can do it, so can you.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah.
And that's why I recommend everybody do that. I use CTime, CTYME.com.
Oh, yeah, it's the anti-spam service. Guys.
Yes. Anonymous Lesbians here.
Woo! It's been a while.
$78.40. She did write a lengthy note.
Oh, good, because I need to ask her some questions in a segment later on that she can help us with.
Thank you both for helping me attain at the age of 40 on July 11th. I don't know, is she on the list?
Yes, she is.
With my sanity intact. My birthday gift to myself is my first associate executive producership. There's no way that I would have made it this far without your help. Now that I live, and then she mentioned where, I'm not going to say where she lives, but it's a big city in the United States. My rate of support has slowed slightly since I am broke.
Oh, how's New York? Everything good there?
Could be San Francisco. This could be, it could be LA.
It could be Austin. Are you kidding me?
Yeah, it could be. It's you can go broke in a lot of cities. But I assure you,
a handwritten note.
But it says I assure you. Then it just changes to a different sentence. Let's just say that I got very quiet when it comes up at dinners, at parties. If it does, I just try to steer the conversation to a safer topic. How embarrassing and how ridiculous Justin Trudeau is. They still find that shocking, but at least they don't call me a xenophobe Nazi like they do if I question. I see. Okay. Sorry. I got the note. She, She labeled
Start over, because it's an interesting note. I want to hear it.
I'll go back to where she just moved. My rate of support has slowed slightly since I am broke, but I assume that – oh, you can assume that it will never go overboard.
Good.
Your coverage of the immigration crisis has been politically useful to me as I am now in the green card process.
Uh-huh.
So she's moved to the United States.
Uh-huh.
To date, I have spent $18,000.
What?
On lawyers and fees.
Holy shit.
And that sure has given me a different perspective on immigration than all of my elite libtard patrons and colleagues. Let's just say that I get very quiet when it comes up at dinners or parties. If it does, I just try to serve the conversation, immigration, that is, to a different, safer topic. How embarrassing and how ridiculous Justin Trudeau is. They still find that shocking. But I, at least they don't call me a xenophobic Nazi like they do if I question
authority
opening the borders.
Mm.
If she questions opening the borders, I don't think it's a good idea to open the borders. You're Nazi! A Nazi. Thanks again from the bottom of my heart for the work you do. I'm going to try to make it to knighthood by my next birthday. Woo. Sincerely, anonymous lesbian. Now, she has. Been given 50. She gave for years. She is pretty close already with this donation, it seems to me.
She must be. She must be.
Yeah. So.
So, anyway, okay. So she was in Scandinavia.
Yeah. She
I don't think I ever realized that she was Scandinavian.
Oh, yeah. She was always Scandinavian.
Oh, cool. Well,
she still is, apparently.
Yeah. She never talks about her lesbianism, but I will have questions about that. So I hope she can send us a follow-up note. No donation needed, just a follow-up note after we get to that segment, because there's a lot, there's some interesting things going on in the community, John, the LGBTQ community.
Yeah, which you deny exists.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Sure do.
I'm sure you're not the only one. Anyway, she gave $278.40. So she'll be the first associated executive producer on today's list. Sir Pete of the High Power Hammerheads, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Whoops, just overshot. Finally made it to the roundtable with my last donation for good measure. Another donation as another thank you for the countless hours of support. NJNK, Sir Pete. Okay, thank you, Sir Pete, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And he's in the Netherlands. Is that snakes? Yeah. Yeah, it's Pete Snakes.
Pete Snakes. Yes, of course it is. He's no longer Sir Pete Snakes. He's Sir Pete of the High Power Hammerheads.
Yeah. Okay. Now we have an extremely long note from Chris Wilson, who
our buddy Chris.
Yeah, buddy Chris at 2:13:08. To today, I'm returning to my duties. On the, you know, that he just quit for like a couple of days, I guess. I thought he was
gonna he was going for a month. He was going off the grid. And he lives in,
that's what I thought.
He lives in a time warp.
Today I'm returning my duties on the SS No Agenda after a good digital detox. While not overboard, you disappeared for one show. I did spend the last fortnight on the dinghy. Yeah. It's a lot of creatives, as they like to be called sometimes, they're like addicted to it. on the dinghy tour behind, strumming guitar and humming the tunes in my head. I'll be catching up on the last 5 shows this week. So I guess he's been gone for 5 shows. Really?
No, I think what he does is he will email us, but he won't watch news, won't go online, won't go on the so schnets, and won't listen to podcasts. So I think what he does is and this is not a bad idea. You know, where's my mouse? Oh, there it is. He just stops, but he does continue to email, which I don't think is really a digital detox. But so that's why it seems like he didn't go anywhere.
Thanks for all the well wishes, like what happened to Eddie Money.
What do you mean, what happened to Eddie Money?
You know Eddie Money, the rocker?
I know Eddie Money very well, actually. Why?
Well, because one day he was doing all these hit songs. And then one day, it was a cocaine binge or something.
He had an accident, too.
This was the accident. He used to play locally in Berkeley all the time.
I did air quotes on the accident, John.
He ended up going into a coma for something over a year.
Yeah, that's right.
And then he came back after a year, and it's like, from my perspective, he never left.
Well, I think we call it a air quotes coma, like maybe going to the spa.
Yeah, the spa.
It's just he had to go to the spa.
Okay. Thanks to all the well wishes for Kylie the Keeper looking good. Though the final results not yet in, we will know for sure this week. Please find my First Amendment and boobs donation of 180.08Q jingle plus another 33 to get over to the line for a read.
I believe completely in the First Amendment and in boobs.
Then I saw her boobs. Now I'm a believer.
Because I like boobs.
That's Sir Chris Wilson's work, of course.
Now for the grousing. I notice when you may stop for your nights, clearly you don't stop for your minstrels. Put down that pen, you drunkard, and pick up your lute. Now go and entertain us forthwith.
He's referring to you. Like, you're like, hey, here's some lyrics. Make a song. Yeah. Yeah. He's slamming you, bro.
Yeah. Well, got the job done.
A minstrel. That's right. At least you got the minstrel to perform. Good work, John.
About the letter I sent in the 20th and 33rd birthday and the subsequent knighting ceremony, I guess Adam was busy prepping. He's blaming you here, too, by the way.
What'd I do?
Bud.
What'd I do?
I guess that Adam was busy preparing for a well-earned break and figured I'd be too drunk to notice. About which he was probably right, but there was an important consideration for the peerage committee in this letter quoted below.
And he actually sent a letter, too, a PDF version. He's perturbed about this.
Yeah, apparently. As for my title, I could be White Knight, as you call me, Sir Chris, prior to my officially qualifying with all the jingles and such that I have contributed. However, as I've never been de-douched, and there was all that anal leakage stuff with the trigger warnings back in the late 2015s, does this make me a brown knight?
Oh, jeez.
He's just rambling here. I shall leave it to the Peerage Committee to decide. No. This is
wait,
allegedly nice.
Can I just check in on the Peerage Committee one more time?
Yeah. What no. Yeah. No brown knights.
No brown knights. All right.
Anyway, goes on. My simple request was ignored. Too bad if I had any special dietary requirements. Got it. For my knighting, I would like Cooper's Pale Ale and Kanga Bangers, as I'm also how are the Kanga Bangers? That would be kind of
sounds
interesting.
Sounds good, doesn't it? Yeah.
From Australia. And as I am also playing in the band, providing the entertainment for the proceedings, my writer includes zucchini and meatloaf. A show support reference. Bear hugs and no homo. And fish is hashtag fish. Yes, hashtag fish. Now, he said he was drunk before. He's definitely drunk. Right?
Yeah.
I'll read it in context. In all seriousness, I'm cool. I get a lot out of the show, as I guess we all do. And I do appreciate the enormous emotional, mental, and in some cases, physical effort you two go to each week to bring us 6 hours of sanity and mirth. I'm also grateful for all the producers that contribute research art jingles, preferred pronoun names, Ben's work, and of course, financial support, which keep you two blokes from having to move in together in Adam's Airstream. Adam, do you still have that?
No, I had to sell it.
Sold it.
Yeah.
And rest assured, after putting down my pen for this note, I shall once again pick up my lute and sing odd odes and sonnets to Maxine Waters and other such douchebags as the producers request to keep you all entertained and your amygdala soothed. Love you guys. No homo. But I did do change my mind. I promised my hairdresser he can have first go.
God.
Shout out to Nick and Drew, the dude's named Ben, who've been helping me with their software that I hit in the mouth during the support calls. Chris.
Oh, my goodness. Chris. Sir Chris, yes. Well, I apologize if... So his whole note is basically because I took an executive decision without mentioning it and did not call him a brown knight. Is that the problem?
It's hard. You know, I read the note. I can't really tell what the problem is.
We need to go. We need to trip down under, man. This guy's in trouble. He needs help.
He needs help.
He needs hugs. He needs hugs. Sir Chris really does. And by the way, it's not jingles. He does full-on songs. He truly is a no-agenda minstrel, and his work is beyond appreciated. And now he's also become a knight. So, and I've got everything.
I always thought he was a knight. That's the thing that I gave him.
That's my mistake. I gave him a sir early on. Just in my mind, somehow.
We used to give gratuitous knighthoods to people who contributed a lot to the show, but no money.
Yeah, but it wasn't discussed. It's you know what? As usual, it's all my mistake. And I'm sorry.
Exactly.
We're good. Okay, onward.
Mariella. Pronounced Mariella. What else does it say on that thing? I can't read the whole thing.
I'm pleased and fortunate to make this donation of 233 today. No,
it was just her name was blocked. I can read it.
I was happy to read it for you.
Okay, read it.
Oh, I am pleased and fortunate to make this donation of $200.33 today in honor of the one-year anniversary of my survival of a subacronoid hemorrhage.
Yes, this is this note, by the way, I want people, pay attention to this note because I'm going to discuss the walk-away phenomenon, which I wouldn't have ever discussed until I heard Scott Adams' presentation on it. And now it's important, I realized. And this note is part of the, along with the anonymous lesbian, is part of the explanation part of what I'm going to talk about.
So this is in honor of her one-year survival of subacronoid hemorrhage, also known as a brain aneurysm. Yes, 1 year ago on July 7th, 2017, my fiance, Colin the Deaf, Dumb, Blind Knight, and EMT by trade, discovered me collapsed with my airway occluded on our neighbor's porch in Portland, Oregon, where he was able to get me breathing again and began the process of saving my life. Many more small miracles amassed that day and throughout my two-month-long hospitalization to get me to where I am today, almost completely unscathed by this massive brain injury and in the top 1% of recovery status for people surviving aneurysms. One of those miracles was the No Agenda Show. Wow. While hospitalized, Colin asked for emergency...
Colin's reading it.
Well, I got that's actually emotions. I can read it perfectly fine. It's just I was taken aback by that.
No, this is a tearjerker note.
While hospitalized, Colin asked for emergency health karma from both of you, and it worked. Moreover, to help me stay grounded and improve my short-term memory recovery, Colin played the NA jingle special by my bedside on several occasions to get me laughing and talking with him about clips we love, like Obama's No, 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 Al Sharpton, etc. It was moments like this in the hospital that sped my recovery along, helped me stay in good spirits through two brain injuries, surgeries, and kept me connected to Colin, showing once again that no agenda is crucial for brain health. Colin hit me in the mouth about 3 years ago, and I couldn't be more grateful for the services you both provide and the opportunities the show has given Colin and I to bond together on many levels. Jeez, it's beautiful. Finally, I wanted to announce that Colin surprised me last week in Glacier National Park, proposing to me in front of two mountain goats at Hidden Lake. These guys are deep. We'll get married next year after 11 years of dating. Ah, couples that deconstruct together stay together. Gentlemen, as I am creeping towards damehood, please reserve the title for me of Dame Ella Hitzgerald of Indiana Cove and consider me your resident speech-language pathologist, here to serve all of your informational needs about language, childhood development, speech behavior, and social communication. Can I get a trains good, planes bad, dealer's choice Al Sharpton, and goat karma, please? Thank you for helping to save my life. Mariella, pronounced Mariella. Holy moly. That's beautiful.
And you might as well give her the Obama no, 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 no thing, which apparently was her favorite in the collection.
Yes. We have a number of them. Okay. Is there anything else you wanted to say about that note while I'm looking for these jingles?
No, but I found that note I found it interesting that he was playing that particular episode, which was the jingle episode that you put together.
Mm-hmm.
Which I think is probably a very curative, because it doesn't have us talking about stuff. It's just a collection of outrageously funny and interesting and kind of poignant jingles that took about 2 hours, 2 hours of jingles, I guess. You could tolerate that a little more than listening to that.
And I wanted to say something about the karma. So John and Adam don't give any karma. I mean, we have no special powers. Well, the only thing, we're trained in rain stickology, but that is a different story.
The rain stick thing we're good at.
That's different. That does require some skill and knowledge. But the karma thing, I was thinking about this. Karma works with the group because everyone hears this, hears whatever the plight is, whether it's a job or house moving or relationship karma. Somehow, in my estimation, after doing this for karma didn't start right away, but probably last seven, eight years, somehow in the collective network that we're all in, it seems to have an effect. The same goes for jobs karma. And here's what I think is the proof. Trump keeps saying jobs, jobs, jobs everywhere he goes. The man is evoking karma, and guess what? Unemployment goes down.
Yeah, I don't know what it is about the saying it three times in a row, but Nancy Pelosi's done it. We actually had a clip of a slew of different politicians saying it three times in a row.
There's
no reason to say jobs, jobs, jobs.
No, who started it? Was it Pelosi who started it, though?
Yeah, Pelosi did when they were trying to pass, or they did pass in the House and never got through the Senate, that crazy bill about almost 10 years ago. That was going to turn us into solar energy. It was this huge. Yeah. This is when Boehner was still the Speaker of the House.
Boehner, I don't see. I know exactly what you're talking about. I can't find it.
I have that.
Oh, okay. I'm just looking for the big jobs thing. Now, I shortened it up a little bit. She also wants some goat karma, so I'm going to do these in rapid tempo. Thank you so much for that beautiful note. We're so happy that you're better. And instead of us asking when you hear something that falls into your field of expertise, like everybody else, just drop us an email. We really appreciate it. That's a big part of how the show is put together.
Hey, listen.
Oh, this is a different one.
You're in my house. Hey.
Wait, I want to do a different one.
Shame on you. You shouldn't be doing this.
That wasn't the one I wanted. It was good, but it wasn't the one I wanted.
I never heard that one.
Oh, that's the same thing. This is the one you're talking about, I think.
No. Listen. No.
Holy shit, this. Oh,
play that one. I haven't heard that one.
No. Hey. No. What? No.
Hey. No, it was the cucaracha.
Yeah, cucaracha.
Cucaracha is the one you want. Okay, that's now. I'll play the sequence. Here we go.
Hey. Listen. No. You're in my house. Hey. Come on, guys. No. Shame on you. Hey. Okay. No. I'm up in the house. Hey. Breaking the booth. No.
All aboard. Train's good. Plane's bad.
Real conflict.
You've got karma.
And thank you again, Mariella, for that fantastic note, and Colin, the deaf, dumb, and blind knight, for doing his duty, saving the damsel. Fantastic. That was really nice.
Yeah, and finally, Baroness Monica, $200.11. Love your show, guys. Can I request house buying karma for Stefan and Lance?
You betcha.
You've got karma.
Yeah, actually, I realized that for Mariella, I forgot she wanted goat karma. So I do want to do it properly since the proposal came in front of goats.
Goat. You've got karma.
All right. Thank you very much. Great notes. From drunk to alive again. I mean, we really cover the spectrum on this show. Fantastic. Those are our associate executive producers and executive producers. They get the titles early in the show because that is how Hollywood's always worked. And it's nice to get credit when you're coming in with big money like that. Thank you for keeping the show going. We'll be thanking Everyone else who came in $50 and above in our second segment. And a reminder that as the Brexit World Cup continues to come to a close, we are on the ball for you. And you can remember us for our show on Thursday at
Dvorak.org/NA.
So you can get people out of sickness into health. That's a formula.
Our formula is this. We go out, we hit people in the mouth.
Shut up, slave. Hey, John, before you go into hashtag walk away thing, I have a setup clip for you, which I think takes it one step further than the actual clip itself, which we don't need to play. The guy behind it, what's his name here? Here it is. I got it. Brandon Straka. Yeah, he was on my least favorite show, the Ingraham Angle, which I didn't watch, but someone sent me the clip. And I really cut this down just so he kind of explains how he came to this, how he came to making this video, which he does call a campaign. And I'm not entirely convinced that he was just by himself doing this. It does sound a lot like that, but it kind of sets you up to understand if you haven't seen the video.
And I will mention that there's some slickness here and there that is a little like.
There's some definitely.
It could be Roger Stone.
It could be. I mean, he talks about a campaign, and there's a little more to it than I think he's letting on. But the general idea is there, and the meme appears to be working. Here he is.
I had a red pill experience in 2017 after the election of Donald Trump. As a matter of fact, I welcome anyone to go to my Facebook page where I still have videos up from 2016 in which I'm crying because Hillary Clinton didn't get elected. I was devastated. No, this is very, very real. You know what's so funny is I created that video a few months ago. And a few months ago, my biggest concern was, the nasty rhetoric, the intolerance, the name calling, the judgment. That was just 2 months ago. And since this video came out, we've already seen a greater shift. Now I'm actually worried about violence. I'm actually like, it's already changed in just 2 months from where, you know, what my concerns were just 2 months ago. Now I'm actually worried that we may be on the brink of an incredibly violent, episode. People are leaving the left by tens of thousands. My group is growing every day by tens of thousands. And it's amazing because it's actually happening on Facebook and people are leaving testimonials. We're getting thousands of testimonials every day that are either through video or written word where people are talking about how the left has become intolerable to them. They don't even recognize their party anymore. And what do these people stand for? I mean, what is their platform? All I can figure out so far is we hate Trump and we love illegal immigrants. And that's what else is there?
Now, were you a Democrat before, Brandon? I'm just curious. What drew you to be a Democrat?
Because I'm gay. Yeah. I mean, that's it.
I have a lot of gay friends who are not Democrats, by the way.
Shut up, Ingraham.
People think they're bizarre.
And I used to be one of those people who would have given them that. But, if you're a minority in America, if you're a black person, if you're Hispanic, if you're gay, there's sort of this assumption that you are not wanted on the right, that you're not welcome on the right, and that you will be protected and cared for if you go to the left and you stick with the liberals and the Democrats. But we've seen now that that's absolutely not true. They really take us for granted. And beyond taking us for granted, they actually, for gay people, have used our fears and our traumas against us, trying to keep us in this constant state of feeling like we're afraid or our rights are in danger or the Trump administration's out to hurt us. And that really upsets me. I want gay people, I want all people, but particularly minorities in America, to know you have a choice. You don't have to vote Democrat just because you're a gay person. You don't have to vote Democrat just because you're a black person. If you're a minority, you have a choice. And that's what this campaign's about.
There you go.
Well, Scott looked at this and he has a very good video. By the way, that guy being gay is funny because you can go on YouTube and catch the stream of walk away videos. Mm-hmm. And there's one, which I think I'll put on the Twitter, of this guy who starts like he's like some guy and he's talking about how he switched over. And he says, but you know, I got to do this right. And then he cuts away and he comes back as a drag queen. And he gives about a 7 or 8 minute pitch as a drag queen about why the Democrats are screwed up and how, you know, how they ostracize people and how he has to fight it now. It's very good. In fact, most of these videos are pretty outstanding. But Scott has this theory that this guy has done nothing more than open up a small window into the fact that the Democrats are abusing and using their constituents and they're doing it using this persuasiveness of fear.
Fear of other Americans.
Yes. And Scott makes that clear. He says the Republicans use fear too, but we use fear of outsiders, of MS-13.
Not we, Trump specifically.
Well, he was referring to the Republican Party.
I saw the video this morning. He specifically said Trump. It doesn't matter. It's fine. Yes.
Okay. Well, anyway, Trump uses according to Adams, uses this outside. We're fearful of that's why we need borders. We need, you know, all this sort of thing. And he says that's completely different than having fear of your fellow citizens and hate and fear aimed inside. And he thinks that's extremely destructive. And he makes it, and this is why I thought the anonymous lesbian clip was kind of important. Not her clip, but her
letter. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And the one that you just read with about the woman with the no agenda stuff being played to her.
Mm-hmm.
Because this is the part of Scott's pitch. This is just a little clip from him. Scott Adams on Walk Away.
Ah. I'm sorry, I didn't know he had a clip. Good, here we go.
That this Brandon Straka, what he's doing is far more important than I imagined when I was just reading the headline about it and I didn't read the detail. Once you see his reason, that he realized the Democrats are manipulating people into this permanent unhealthy, very, very physically and mentally unhealthy. Have I mentioned unhealthy state? So the Democrats, for their political benefit, have caused the entire left to be in physical and mental distress for 2 years? Policy schmolicy. Does policy matter to you if you realize that your own team has made you deeply unhealthy for 2 years intentionally for their own game?
That was a little Scott Adams persuasive move by itself.
Oh, yeah.
Actually.
No, he's repeating. He's doing all his tricks. Yeah, but he's making the point that we kind of make on this show.
Kind of. We just had someone make it for us.
Yeah. Well, that's true. We've been saying it all along that it's unhealthy to have this kind of lefty attitude about things because it's contradictory, doesn't make a lot of sense. So I have one. So the walkaway videos are all interesting, and I would recommend people listening to them because it's all kind of confessional stuff. These people are all like this one. I have one clip. I'm not going to play any more than this one, and this is a minute clip from one of the girls, and she talks about her background as a progressive social justice warrior who somewhere along the lines got, and by the way, a lot of these walk away YouTube videos are black guys.
Yeah,
and black women.
Well, there's actually, we'll play this clip, but in my wrap up, I'm going to say that, yes, we're seeing the main groups is black Americans. And that's the main, if you just the algos are presenting that to me on YouTube. You find one of them, you find this guy, and underneath it's a whole bunch of black Americans all saying, hey, man, we got screwed by this party. And we were raised to believe, hey, you're black, you vote Democrat. That's how they were raised.
That guy with that specific term.
A lot of guys saying that.
Well, anyway, so this is a woman who has kind of come all the way from progressive pro-Bernie voter to this. And this is just a piece of what she's doing as she's doing her. These are all confession booth things. It's very interesting to listen to.
And, yeah, I won't be voting for a party that calls everybody racist and Nazis
And I'm hoping the hysteria will die down because it's really disheartening. You know, I can't, this is a second YouTube or a second Facebook channel because I can't even go on my regular channel. This, you know, my Facebook feed is just cancer. It's just people hating on each other. I'm not going to have, I like people. When I'm in, you know, when you're around people face to face, they're nice. People are generally good. You get on social media and it's just a cesspool. I can't even do Twitter. Yeah, so I'm not going to do it. This campaign has sort of made me hopeful because reading people's comments and seeing that people can have a dialogue with each other, even though, you know, maybe somebody's pro-choice, pro-life, they're not being awful to each other. And that's how we should be. And that's, you know, I'm hoping that we can get there. So anyways, keep up the good work, everybody. I really enjoy your videos.
Too bad about the anyways. Otherwise, it was a good clip.
Yeah, well, but the thing, that clip in there that I thought you'd get a kick out of, which is Facebook is cancer.
Yeah. Yeah. Hello. I'm cancer free. What am I now? 2 months cancer free, I think. I'm very, yeah, very proud of this.
Yeah, you're just like an alcoholic.
Well, it's an easy prediction to make, but I'm quite sure. And you know, we did talk about this on the last show about in a different context about the walkaway campaign. I've been following this, so I've seen all the Black Americans. The next group is going to be, well, we already see gay men, and the gay men have been ostracized because, as I've said for many years, there is no such thing as the LGBT community. I'm not going to go harping on it, but I want to provide some evidence. And if you look at Brandon Straka's video, he says right there, you know, that we're being ostracized and that we're the bad people of the LGBTQ. But I think the realization is going to come into play from people who are the full acronym is LGBTQQIAAPK, which includes kink at the end. And I think really it's LGBT is really what we have, lesbian, gay, transgendered. All the rest, you know, bisexual, bicurious, allied, intersex. It's all just reasons for other people on the left to belong to the group when it's convenient for them, I think. And queer is another one. But now the wheels are coming off the LGBTQ bandwagon. Because the gay guys feel ostracized by everybody in the group because they're men, you know, so they suck no matter what. And quite honestly, most gay guys I know act like a-hole men, except they're doing it with other men. You know, it's like sex first, talk later, all this stuff. But now the lesbians are up in arms, and I told you that there's a problem with the trans community, and that is a community, although everyone's their own individual. Now there's this thing that the lesbians are up in arms about. It's called lesbian erasure. Have you heard this?
Now you got me.
This is what I want to know about hear from our anonymous lesbian.
You would.
Yes, there was a big protest even because you know Gay Pride or Pride Day. I can't even say Gay Pride. Pride Day is happening everywhere. The next couple of months, you'll see Pride parades everywhere.
Pride Month.
It is. Well, it's, yeah, Pride Quarter actually. And so there was a big lesbian protest against this lesbian erasure. You'll have to let your ears adjust for a second because a lot of crowd noise. But see if you can hear what this guy interviewed a couple of the women who were walking up front in this parade.
Why are you protesting today?
We're protesting against lesbian erasure. Sorry.
What does that mean?
What does that mean? Well, do you know anything about trans ideology?
I do.
Okay, well then you'll know about lesbian erasure, won't you? There are men who are saying that they're lesbians.
And why have you chosen to disrupt the parade today?
Because it's a gay pride event, isn't it?
Out of pride! Get the L out of pride! Get the L out of pride!
You disagree with transgender people being here?
Absolutely not. Absolutely not. I do disagree with men saying that they're women and that they're lesbians. I've got nothing against people cross-dressing or anything else, but I don't believe that you can change sex.
Stop erasing lesbians! Stop lesbian erasure!
I don't know if that was audible at all for you.
Well, I heard a couple of things. One about guys saying they're lesbians.
Yeah, trans saying they're lesbians.
And well, didn't she say guys? Yeah. Guys, but the way, guy self-identifying as a lesbian?
Well, no, what she's saying is when you have a trans person who is trans from male to female, they are now saying, well, I'm a lesbian. And they're saying, no, you can't be a lesbian because you have to be a woman. You have to have a female genitalia to be a lesbian. So it doesn't really matter, other than this was never meant to be a group, and it shouldn't be, and no one should accept being lumped in by a group by anyone, certainly not by politicians or, worse, a political party. By the way, screw political parties. They're the scourge. They're all paid by the same people. The parties are shit.
But they're mechanisms to get elected. That's the problem. This is true. You can't get rid of it.
Well, not if you're AOC. She doesn't have a real party. But beyond the point.
She'll have a real party if she gets into trouble.
I think these are going to be the next people who are going to walk away. Is the LGBTQ community, who are going to be sick and tired of lumped together as a bunch of poor saps. I won't do my whole rant. As a bunch of poor saps over in the corner who need to be protected. That's over, and I think that is happening organically, and this walkaway movement is going to help in that. And good for them. It's crazy. It sickened me for a long time.
Yeah.
All right.
Well, it's something to follow. We're on top of it.
Yeah, well, I
don't see this on the mainstream media that we're really discussing this. Except that Laura Ingraham had that one guy on, and I consider that fringe.
That's about it. As a short entremont? No entremont. I got an error. Oh, that's too bad. What the hell?
There you go.
They're all erroring out. What is this?
You're having a problem.
Yeah, I had an Ask John all produced and everything. What's happening here?
No, you got to reboot.
No. Something's wrong.
I got an entremont then.
Okay, shoot.
This will cheer everybody up.
Okay.
San Francisco real estate prices.
Oh, yeah, that'll cheer me up, I'm sure.
It's no secret San Francisco real estate is pricey and getting more expensive by the year. But new numbers show just how incredible the spike is. San Francisco home prices are now rising $205,000 a year. That translates to $561 every day. And here's a little more perspective. In 1997, the median price of a home was $274,000. Now it's $1.62 million. The data was compiled by the San Francisco company Paragon Real Estate.
Sell, Dvorak. Sell. Sell. Now. Get out.
Why?
It's, dude,
it's almost like living for free.
Well, yeah, you know the cycles better than anybody, but that can't last forever. It just can't.
Doesn't have good positions. You can just don't even need to work. If real estate prices on a median house are going up $500 a day, well, this is in San Francisco, by the way. It's not quite the same where I live.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's all spreads. All the boats rise a bit.
Yeah.
But if it's going up that much, you're pretty much making that much money on a daily basis, which is a couple hundred thousand dollars a year.
Yeah, but
without doing anything, without lifting a finger? Yeah, I mean, come on. Why would anybody give that up?
Think of your health, man.
Are you kidding me? The kind of fruits and vegetables we get around here?
Okay.
There's nothing like it.
Okay. Oh, man. I was looking into, you know, I'm a little obsessed about Austin becoming San Francisco 2.0, which was literally called that by a homeless guy, not a mentally ill or drug addict.
Was it the guy that was shipped there from San Francisco on a bus?
No, it's a guy who just travels around, and he didn't ask me anything on Reddit. And he said, you know, one of the questions was, well, why does everyone come into Austin? He said, oh, the word is out. It's San Francisco 2.0. Now, it's not, luckily. There's one key difference, and you brought this up a couple of shows ago. And I've heard other people speak about it, so I put a couple of these links in the show notes. What really happened is the most recent addition to what was originally, I think, Proposition 47, then it was Proposition 57, which decriminalized to such an extent any type of theft or any type of crime, misdemeanor, under $950 that the cops don't even show up for it anymore. And the final kind of nail in the coffin, I think, was when Jerry Brown added to these laws that if you claim you were mentally insane, they kind of let you go right away. So now you have this, hey, if they catch me and it's on the 950, it's probably not going to be anything wrong anyway. And if I just say I have mental issues, then it's off the table. You just get let free again. And according to this AMA guy as well, you can steal whatever you want. You won't go to jail. So why not hang out there? And this is now being heralded as the genesis of this massive problem throughout the state of California.
Yeah, I think that's probably true.
Whereas in Austin, it's still, we have normal limits.
The number of people's cars whose windows are broken, it's like hundreds every day. And, they're grabbing nothing. They bust the window, they see something in there, they grab a bag of groceries, whatever you leave in the car. It's in San Francisco specifically, mm-hmm. not so much every place else. And little towns is not happening at all. I mean, you can't do that. So nobody wants to be in a little town, but that's where you should be, because if your car window gets broken and somebody steals something, you can call the cops and they'll actually check it out.
Right.
Not in San Francisco. They don't care.
Well, in Austin, luckily, the misdemeanor laws and the penalties are still pretty stiff. So Class A misdemeanor, which is assault causing bodily injury, driving while intoxicated, that's... Oh, and a theft of property with a value to $500 to $1,500. You still go to jail for that. And even Class B misdemeanors, which is less than 2 ounces of marijuana, and that's theft of property with a value of $50 to $500, you still can go to jail for 6 months. So, but already, I'm just researching this because I live here. There's talk about, we're too strict on the homeless. I'm serious. We should allow them.
Slippery slope.
Oh, yeah. They can't make a living if they can't stand on the street corner. So now they're going to be allowed to stand on the street corner and solicit money. I've stopped. I used to give money all the time. You know me. I used to do that.
Yes, you used to. I'll tell everybody this if they don't know it, because there are listeners that don't listen to the show from day one. You had a policy of, and I kind of adopted this policy, which is that if you see somebody that really asks you for money, you give them a fiver, which isn't like, it's a little bit kind of, patronizing. It's a little bit snooty. It's a fiver for you, but I think they like it. They appreciate it. They, $5 is, what is it nowadays?
Yeah. Well,
as opposed to giving it. Nothing, or not looking at them, or
not even acknowledging their existence,
which I think that's going to get you into trouble. And you see it in San Francisco because of all the Silicon Valley goofballs that are making, $250 a year easy, taking the bus ride down to Mountain View or whatever they're doing. And they won't even look at the homeless.
No.
Don't look at them.
Yes. Step over them. I remember stepping over the same guy when I went to walk to the office, but I stopped doing that in Austin, and I'm seeing the same guys come across the street. Of course, they know me. Hey, Adam, how you doing? But I don't just give a fiver. I talk to him, said, what are you going to do with it? What's your plan? And this was the guy who was, I'm going to buy socks, and I was going to buy shoes. And then he's still out there. And he said, how you doing? Yeah, I'm pretty good. And I was on my way to the spin class. And he says, so what are you up to? Well, I'm just trying to scrounge up a few bucks to get a burger. Got any money on you? He said, no, I'm not doing that anymore because I've given you a lot of money collectively over the years and you've done nothing. So how come, what is the problem? Well, yeah, he didn't really have an answer. And it's just like, but he also didn't get mad. He was like, fuck it. Curry's off the list. They'll find some other guy. And they're making between $50 and $100 a day. Think about it. This AMA was, and there's a link in the show notes as well. It was really interesting. They sleep on the top of luxury apartment buildings. There's tons of construction going on here. So they'll go in, sleep, go to sleep early, get up early before construction workers come. There's plenty of places where there's free Wi-Fi. They can, so I charge up my cell phone. I get enough money every day to buy a beer, a sandwich, maybe some weed if I'm into it. And that's his life. Now, that's not the same for everybody, of course, who's experiencing homelessness. But my plan seems to be working.
I used to come to this mall all the time. This is my third time coming to this shelter. But so far, I've only been here like almost a month. I'm okay. Thank you.
All right, well, you can come back.
I'm already working. I'm a security guard. My grandma died, and that's who I was living with my whole life. And I didn't have no other family, nowhere to go.
This used to be the Macy's at Landmark Mall many moons ago, but it's now taken on new life as a retrofitted homeless shelter. Many people come into shelter already employed. The problem is more that their employment isn't sufficient to allow them to live comfortably at, you know, market rate rent. So all it really takes is one instance of bad luck and somebody living close to the poverty line or living marginally can find themselves suddenly unable to pay rent, facing eviction and ultimately homelessness. The solution ultimately to homelessness is to find something that they can afford. They might not be spending 30% of their income, but find somewhere that, you know, is a safe roof over their head that they can build from.
So the point of that clip, twofold. One, that homelessness comes from many different reasons, mainly just no place to live where you're working, where you're scraping by. And two, there you go. That's in Virginia, an empty mall. That's a Macy's they turned into a shelter. I'm telling you, this is the way forward.
You got the right idea. You nailed it.
Yeah.
I was still thinking of like the sex shops.
But back to Germany. No, but if you think about it, if we want affordable housing and no investor is willing to build that, they're just not. They're not building it. Let's build, you know, like the banker's idea, although, you know, it has to be lower price. Let's build dorm-like. Malls are really well suited. They have fantastic bathroom facilities because they have to be able to handle a lot of bathroom traffic. Now, they don't have showers, but, you know, there's all kinds of, those would be minor adaptations, I think. And you're kind of done, and, you know, you can put up, these things are built for creating a new space and put up walls, and there's all kinds of things you can do. So I think instead of calling it a shelter, let's turn it into some affordable housing. Yeah, and then, you know, maybe the guys who invested in these malls who have written it off anyway, they can still get a little bit of money back instead of letting it just, well, of course, we could turn it into like the German sex shop thing, but that won't fly in every state.
How about a combination? That would be interesting.
Combo. Okay, John. Mocking the homeless once again.
Yeah, mocking.
Well, speaking of which, got a note from a producer who you'll call Nate. What is your rule of economics? And the economy in general?
Yeah, the hookers get better looking.
Yeah. The more the economy goes down. Yeah, when the economy goes down, then the hookers get better looking. Greetings and salutations, longtime listener, small donor. Let's just say my name is Nate. I live in Atlanta. I want you to know that as a sex worker, you guys are pretty much right on with your assessment of, quote, as the economy gets shittier, the sex workers get hotter. Although it has gotten much more difficult since the U.S. government has cracked down on Craigslist and Backpage, it's pretty much funneled things to a few websites, not sure where the ladies advertise their wares, but almost all men have switched to a website called rentmen.com. That's some marketing right there.
Rentmen?
Rentmen.com. Jeez. It's a shame we have to keep our wares in the dark. After all, it's just sex. They say it's about sex trafficking, but I'm almost positive it's really about taxation. I can say it hasn't changed the game at all, other than just being pigeonholed into one website, maybe two. I promise to throw a donation to you guys after this weekend. It's got a big weekend planned. I wish you would make a trip. John, he has a note for you. I wish you would make a trip to Atlanta. I would definitely be able to show you a good time around town. Either way, I'm just getting done and putting my cash in a shoebox, which has proven to be way better than the bank. Selling dick has been exponentially more lucrative than any of the other jobs I've mastered. Just want to tell you to keep up the good work and to expect a nice donation coming soon. Much love from the East Coast from Nate. So there you go. The economic theory holds true.
Yeah, well, it's logical. That's why.
Extremely. I was just going to see if I had something else in this category. No, I don't think so. Go.
Yeah, I think we're good. So there's been a bunch of, you know, I was thinking of Roger Stone, you know, being behind one thing or that. And there's also, I want to mention, I was going to mention it earlier, that when we see some of these crazy things like the jingles and the No Borders, and sometimes you have to wonder if it's actually the Republicans behind some of these things, because it would be a great way to
giving them a lot of credit.
I know they're not that bright. Mm-mm. But with Roger Stone and guys like that, I can see it. But in the meantime, what's really going on with the media is the smear campaigns are really hitting up, going long. And I have a couple of them here. I got one or maybe two. I think they're the same one. Jim Jordan.
Yeah, they are the same. Same length, so I presume they're the same.
Yes, obviously the same thing. So let's play at least a couple of these smears that are going on. And they shouldn't be played at all, but it's all innuendo. Jim Jordan is the congressman from Ohio who just laid into Rosenstein and he was just a prick during some congressional hearings against these guys that are the Mueller investigation.
Mm-hmm.
Mueller.
Yeah.
He is. And so they found some dirt on him, supposedly. And I think it's bullcrap, because I was thinking of the logic of it. But let's play Jim Jordan smear. This is on NBC, of course.
And a $5,000 signing bonus for master automotive technicians.
We're definitely in need of great talent, and great talent's
this
really,
is
really
Jim
difficult.
Jim Jordan
to
smear?
Yeah, Jim Jordan smear. 4 minutes?
Oh, you know what it is?
No.
No, I can't play it because obviously I clipped where I was supposed to clip out of the 4 minutes.
It's on it's on the cutting room floor.
No, it's probably not on the cutting room floor. It's in this clip, but it's after this story and the next story.
Well,
probably.
I can fast forward. I can find it. Hold on.
I'll fast forward. So I
and laid to rest on U.S. soil.
Assistant wrestling coach at Ohio State.
There it is.
Four former Ohio State wrestlers.
This?
Yeah, that's it.
Okay.
And did nothing about it.
Well, let me go back a little. Here we go.
Remains were discovered and
all right, this is the last bit of this.
And laid to rest on U.S. soil.
The family has a headstone at Arlington, hoping his remains will be returned this time. Andrea Mitchell, NBC News, Washington.
A powerful congressman is strongly denying allegations that he knew about sexual abuse when he was an assistant wrestling coach at Ohio State University and did nothing about it. Among those defending Republican Congressman Jim Jordan, President Trump, who called him an outstanding man. Katie Beck has our report.
Four former Ohio State wrestlers tell NBC News they were sexually abused by a team doctor, molested by Dr. Richard Strauss, who they allege inappropriately touched athletes' genitals during routine exams and regularly showered with them in a university facility.
God. I mean, it was just, it's public knowledge. I mean, everyone knew within the athletic department that Doc was a serial groper at best.
Several accusers believe it was known by Republican Ohio Congressman Jim Jordan at the time, an assistant wrestling coach at the university from 1986 to 1994. Jordan denies knowing anything about the allegations before accusers spoke out this spring.
If there had been any reports of abuse, I would have reported it.
Jordan, a member of the Conservative Freedom Caucus, recently made headlines for grilling investigators in the Russia probe.
And I want to know why you won't give us what we've asked for.
Also rumored to be vying to become the next Speaker of the House.
The timing is kind of interesting. It's right after the big hearing with Mr. Rosenstein. It's right when there's all this talk about a Speaker's race.
Alleged victims, some who say they still consider Jordan a friend, say his denials are hurtful and believe Jordan knew what was going on and chose to look the other way. Strauss died in 2005, but the university now investigating the claims against him. Questions remain about the possible crimes or a cover-up. Katie Beck, NBC News.
Before you launch into deconstruction, my filters were not off. My guard was not up when this story came out. I wasn't interested. I was looking at something else. And I heard this. I'm like, another shithole Republican. Makes sense. Of course. Throw the guy in the trash.
Yeah. Well, you should have had some filters going.
Well, that's why you're here.
That is this is just a smear. I like the way it put at the end. Cover up. They throw the word cover up in. I mean, this piece, which is NBC again, is really slanted in a funny way. I don't think they did as good a job as they could have. But there's the unreported is the number of people that came to his defense. But they made it sound like the Republicans are already bailing out on
this
guy.
Yeah, that's what I thought, too. Absolutely.
Yeah, but it's bullcrap. And it's the problem is he's going to be going for the next Speaker of the House. He's a bit of a conservative firebrand that would be a tough and interesting Speaker of the House. And I think it's the Republicans that are trying to
get him out.
Yeah, I don't believe this is a Democratic ploy. They don't care. I mean, it's no reason. I mean, Rosenstein's a Republican. Mueller's a Republican. But they're part of the Trump-hating wing, which is most of them. And they're just trying to – this is a smear. It's a smear campaign because they don't want him to become Speaker of the House because he's going to be a troublemaker.
So he's not guilty of any wrongdoing?
I really doubt it. I think this is all innuendo and bullcrap. And it's from 50. The guy who was the gropers was been dead for 13 years. I mean, talk about dredging up old stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, it's unbelievable that they did this. But this is not the only one. They're also going after another smear. And I'm looking at them as smears. They're just smears. Very straightforward. Is this attorney general guy who I guess is the attorney general, another Republican in Indiana. And it's kind of a funny little smear. This is Attorney General smear.
In Indiana, top Republicans are calling on Attorney General Curtis Hill to resign after four women accused him of sexual harassment. The women, including a state representative, say that Hill groped them at an Indianapolis bar in March. Yesterday, Indiana's governor and two GOP state house leaders said the Republican Attorney General should step down. Hill has denied the allegations and refused to resign.
Yeah, Judy breathing heavy there.
She does. She breathes a lot.
They got a little compressor on her.
This was an PBS report again. It's a smear. The Republicans are very quick. They're all freaked out about the Me Too thing. That's why I think that they weren't happy with it.
I think it's being abused, the Me Too thing.
It's totally being abused.
I mean, the same. I have a clip of Trudeau, and you know someone's behind this, bringing this crap up for him.
The Prime Minister has now acknowledged apologizing to a woman who accused him of groping her. The accusation dates back to a music festival almost two decades ago. Today, Justin Trudeau appeared on CBC Toronto's radio program Metro Morning. He told host Matt Galloway he made that apology, even though he doesn't remember any inappropriate behavior.
Even in the moment of where she recalls me being apologetic, I did not know to what she was referring. I do not feel that there was any inappropriate action of any type. But, and this is the really important thing, it is not just my experience that matters in this.
If you don't believe that anything inappropriate happened, why did you apologize?
Because and that's a great question, because it's one that I've been reflecting on as well.
That's not a great question.
If I apologized, it was because I saw that she had been made uncomfortable, and I did not want her to be uncomfortable, regardless of whether I knew why she was uncomfortable or not.
If you had a few minutes to talk with her, what would you say to her now?
Wow.
I wouldn't say anything. I'd listen. I'd listen to try and understand what her perspective, what her experience was, and reflect on how I could have done differently. Even though I don't think I did anything wrong, that's not the whole story anymore.
Well spun, Juss.
I'm giving you a borderline clip of the day for digging that one up. We need more Trudeau stuff.
Thank you. I love how he's been smeared. All right, Secret Agent Paul has hooked me up again just before our break here.
Ask John, he knows what's going on.
That's right, Ask John, everybody. We're flipping the script, we're turning the tables, we're asking you a question.
Okay.
Clip comes first, pay attention, hand on buzzer.
There's been an embarrassing fail for a space startup in Japan. The Pencil rocket was supposed to soar as high as 100 kilometres into space, but came crashing back down to Earth seconds after liftoff. It's believed...
Okay. The question for the Ask John segment, why did the Japanese rocket blow up? What was wrong?
Well, I saw these clips of the rocket blowing up. It went up about 50 feet and came back down and blew up. I would say that it looks like the engine cut out.
Remember, this is mainstream media reporting, John.
It's believed it suffered a glitch in its main engine.
A glitch! Shut up about the glitch!
I'm going to show my support by donating to No Agenda. Imagine all the people who could do that. Oh, yeah, that'd be fab.
Yeah, on No Agenda.
James Murray. Oh, by the way, on the birthday list, you got the birthday list there?
I got the birthday list.
Anonymous lesbian is born on July 11th. She's on the list?
Yes.
She's
on the list. I don't know her age, but she's on the list for the 10th.
Jay?
Is she the 10th or the 11th?
11th.
11th, yes. And the keeper, also on the 11th.
Holy moly.
It's a trifecta of babes.
And it's all women.
Yes. This, write down this date.
Well, I thought it was great because I could remember my daughter's birthday, 7-11. How can you forget that?
And you know she can get free drinks all this month.
Is that right?
Yeah. Yeah, if you go there and you buy, you'd say, hey, it's my birthday. Where? You show them ID, you get a free at 7-11.
At 7-11? What kind of a free drink would you want from them? Do they make a gimlet?
A big gulp? I don't know. Tina's always jacked about that. I'm going to go. I'm going to get my free drink. She's great.
James Murray, Huntington Beach, California, 10490. Being Adam's age, sorry about age here, the hearing aid talk has been very informative to me. However, having a shaved head, I'm looking for a subdermal implant. Please have Adam research. Oh, yay. Adam?
Yes.
Research that. Research that.
Well, thanks for the hairy ear hole pics. You know, this is exactly why I didn't want to do this. And I trim my ear hair, you know, to a certain degree. The hair is there for a reason, but it wasn't like I had a big bush growing out, like partially growing out of my head.
To be honest about it, I didn't even notice it. I was more interested in the fact that this little implant that goes in the ear is black for some reason. Why didn't I make it flesh color?
That's a great question. Uh-oh. It is a great question, apparently. No. I will ask my audiologist, because it's actually the... both the receiver, that's the little speaker, which they call a receiver, is kind of light gray. And then you can have different plugs on top of it, depending on your ear canal diameter. And those are indeed black. And yeah. I think probably if it wasn't black, you know, it would be a lot more conspicuous because, you know, the inside of your ear hole is black.
No.
Okay, mine is.
Yeah, if you go into where you can't see it, it's black. But what you can see is flesh colored, and this thing would be sitting on top of, you know, it could be darker flesh.
I personally, I ordered these months ago, maybe a year ago, a Kickstarter. I thought that would be interesting to try. What are they called now? But their idea is if you can't cover it up, turn it up, and so it's these little black, kind of like ruby cut. Knobs that you shove into your ear and it goes into your ear canal is how it sticks in there. It's got all the digital signal processing, all the tech in there, but it's just like a fashion statement. So it's actually a bit like you've gauged your ear hole, big black hole. Yeah, but well, I'm going to try those, but I'm not going to go for the subdermal implant. Thanks.
Yeah, no, you shouldn't. You'd be a big lump. If you have some kind of a, cyst.
Yeah, but I will share my ideas and settings with people if they're interested, because it's all about the settings.
Oh.
Anyway, onward.
All right. Paul?
Arsenault
in Jasper, Alberta, Canada. 100. Knighthood is mine, and I would like to be known as Sir Scandinavian...
At par.
At par. Hmm. This is my third donation, as many episodes originally ready to donate $33 per month, but 3 years without a donation means I owe you. Keep going the excellent
work. He says, keep up the excellent work.
Okay. All caps seem to work. Jeffrey Yerke over there in Concord, California, the guy helped me do all the... Red Fox albums.
Oh, 99. Oh, nice.
Another one of my projects. He needs a de-douching.
Okay.
You've been de-douched.
$99.99 is what he gave for a donation. He wants a Brolf Fauci thing we can do later, maybe.
Good to be here, Brolf.
Done.
Sir Nubbin in Indianapolis, Indiana, 8008. That is the boob donation.
Boob.
Sir Kevin McLaughlin, the Viscount of Luna in Locust, North Carolina. Simon Palwoda.
Palwoda
in West Hartford, Connecticut. Another boob. So shout out to Brian Moss.
Massey.
Hitting me in the mouth. Okay. James Scott in Parlin. Why are we getting all these boob donations today?
Did you have a link? Did you have a link in the newsletter?
No, I had no link in the newsletter.
There you go.
And last show we did, and we got none.
It's like real life. When you don't beg for the boob, they show up.
James Scott in Parlin, New Jersey. Boob. Wish he could donate more, he says. Elizabeth Pendergrass in Fayette, Alabama. 7418.
She needs a de-douching.
You've been de-douched.
You see, women, I think women are walking away and coming to us.
Paul Webb and Twickenham, Middlesex, Great Britain, 7418, which is funny because it's, you know.
Well, he does say, sorry, it's late, but happy kicking us out of your country day.
Yeah. So Brian Green of Hams in Chelmsbury, Illinois, 73 is KC9YJM.
73 is Kilo 5, Alpha, Charlie.
Baron Mark Tanner, 6666. Peter Federici, 5555. He's a jobs camera for his partner, Glenn. We do that at the end. Josephus Van Veldhoven, 55 double nickels on the dime. Carrie. Wow.
Chim?
C-C-H-I-M. Chim?
I like this. I can't afford this, but screw it. I need to support the show. Thank you, Carrie Chim.
Thank you. Thank you. We really appreciate that, actually. Sir Slarty Bart Fast. Oh, Slarty. Yeah, Slarty. Keeper of the Cranky Bits. 5510 from Hope, Rhode Island. Neil Latimer in Roanoke, West Virginia. 5510. Not quite sure why, since it's a long note. I'm used to each No Agenda show being better than the last.
Okay. I know what this is. We were joking around about Meghan Markle and the emoluments clause.
Yes, this guy. Right. Okay.
And, you know, we read the Constitution. It clearly says you have to be in office. But I think we were just goofing around. And I think people took us very seriously.
I think it would be great if they arrested her.
Yeah. I was like, here, what Neil is saying, although he's donating, which is appreciated, Thursday show is your weakest showing in recent memory. Bastardized interpretation of the emoluments clause. Okay. And
I think what's more annoying is you forced me to defend Maxine Waters, he says.
Really?
But there's plenty that Maxine Waters is wrong about that you don't have to misinterpret there were a number of actually in response to this. You just like, no, she was referring to the black community.
Yeah. And what does he also say here? Your apparent willful inability to discern between a voluntary DNA test taken by a person and one compelled by the government violating their rights. Now you have no rights at the border. They can do that to me too. There's no Fourth Amendment at the border. And they think it's a basic human right. That's a basic human right to protect children who are being trafficked. Oh, jeez.
Yeah.
And press freedom. Okay. Well, I disagree.
No, he's off the rails and he's in dimension A, B, mm-hmm. One of them. Anyway, that's Neil. Neil Lattimore in Roanoke, Virginia. Makes sense where he lives. Scott Waldher. And by the way, all we did was read from. There's about two people that caused something. All we did was Adam picked up the Constitution and read from it.
Yeah.
And there's one
and
guy
and we joked
on
about Meghan Markle getting
interpreted it. You misinterpreted it.
People don't listen. And, you know, and podcast, I will say podcast is great and not so great. I produce the sound of the show specifically for personal listening experiences. Now, a lot of people will listen to it together, but it's meant to be listened to on headphones or earbuds. I believe that our entire sound is shaped around you creating an environment where you can really listen. a lot of people multitask during podcast consumption.
Yes, they do.
And I know Tina listens to our show
twice. And they won't take the time to back it up and actually listen.
And they listen to it on double speed or speed and a half. You're missing things. You're missing nuance. You're missing. I'm against the. And please don't email me because every single time I bring this up, I listen to one at 1.5 speed. It's just fine. Although I talk like this now for some reason. It's, you know, listening is an important skill that we're losing. So stick the buds in your ear. That didn't come out right, but you know what I meant.
Sir Tom, Scott Waldherr in Middleton, Wisconsin, 5510. Sir Tom Dari in DeForest, Wisconsin, 5510. Anonymous, 5510. What's he got here? Just a little note. And the following people are $50 donations, name and location only. We have a lot today. We had one two shows ago. It's weird. Larry Hay in Mooresville, North Carolina. Sir Reddy Kilowatt. Tony Smith in Fort Worth, Texas. Mary Krenzel in Ipswich, Massachusetts. Robert Dreikison in Oshkosh, Bagosh, Wisconsin. David Eckersley in Bellevue, Washington. Roy Pingle in Forest Hills, New York. David Russell in Aurora, Colorado. Victor Munoz in Miami, Florida. Anthony Sammons in Augusta, Georgia. David Schlesinger in Rosemont, Illinois. Jonathan Meyer in Xenia, Ohio. There's a lot. Edward Mazurek in Memphis, Tennessee. Joseph Pumphrey in Brandon, Mississippi. And finally, David Run in Osterbro, Denmark. And Kyle Myers.
Kevin Myers
in Atlanta, Georgia. And Sir Brian Watson in Raleigh, North Carolina. And Jason DeLuzio in Oklahoma City, California. Plus Sir Alan Bean in Oakland over here. Hi,
okay,
Alan.
Let me just do those last three. Jason DeLuzio in Chatsford, Pennsylvania. Sir Brett Farrell in Oklahoma City. And Sir Alan Bean in Oakland. Okay, we got him.
Did I break up?
No, you did him a little out of order. It's the bionic eye today. It's failing you a little bit. That's okay. Theremin. No, hey, no theremin. It's a medical condition. And I keep saying between your eye and my ears, we should have, you know, free parking.
For some reason we don't count.
Hey, thank you very much. I love seeing these 50s on the list. You know, you add them up, they add up, and it's really helpful. So that is appreciated, and we look forward to more support from everybody for Thursday's show. For that, remember us at
Dvorak.org/NA.
And, of course, we thank everybody who came in under $50 as well as requested.
Jobs, 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 and jobs. Let's vote for jobs.
You've got karma.
Well, as promised, a bevy of babes today in the birthday list. It's a bevy of birthday babes. We start with the anonymous lesbian, Jay Dvorak, and Tina Marie the Keeper. All three of these lovely ladies will be appearing at Sparks. We'll be celebrating on the 11th of July. We congratulate them, and we love them all very much. Happy birthday from Adam and John. It's your birthday, yeah. But it would be funny if they all appeared at Sparks together. Two knightings today, if you can, there's mine, if you can grab your blade.
Yeah, you got it right.
That would be helpful, okay. Up on stage, Chris Wilson. Oh, hold on to the railing, Chris. Paul Arsenault, we'd like you here as well. Gentlemen, both of you supported the best podcast in the universe, the amount of $1,000 or more. That gives you a seat here at the round table of the No Agenda Knights and Dames. And I'm proud to pronounce the Sir Chris Wilson and Sir Scandinavian. Gentlemen, for you, we have Hookers and Blow, Rent Boys and Chardonnay, Cooper's Pale Ale and Kanga Bangers, Zucchini and Meatloaf, Chilled Polish Potato Wodka, Horse Head Pumpkin Ale, Parliaments and Pale Ale, Waifus and Waffles, Steel Reserve and Black Milds, Breast Milk and Pap, Geishas and Sake, Bong Hits and Bourbon, Reuben S. Reuben and Rosé, Ginger Ale and Gerbils, and Sparkling Cider and Escorts and Mutton and Mead. That's all found at noagendanation.com/rings. We got a lot of pale ale drinkers or ale drinkers in general at the round table, I just noticed. Yeah. Cooper's Pale Ale. We got
Horsehead
Horsehead Pumpkin Ale. Yeah, well, it's just notable. Notable. Notable.
Did you look further down on the list of donors to the guy who says that the I just wonder if you saw this video or if you should look at this video, not on the show, but later.
No.
The guy who says he's got 4 minutes of evidence proving
that. Oh, the
that
Vegas shooter?
Yeah.
No, I haven't looked at that.
Oh, okay. We'll look at it later.
Okay. Yeah, definitely.
I'm glad you all enjoyed that.
Hey. All right. Yeah. Let me see. I have a couple of fun things that... oh, yes. We've been talking a lot about Scandinavia today. This is another one of these, and I'm sure the M5M in Scandinavia has done a good job of riling everybody up. You know, the tariffs kicked in, everyone's all pissed off everywhere, and, you know, the world kept on turning. But the lie that has been propagated throughout Canada is a disturbing one, because it literally is a lie, the way it's, maybe it's not. Maybe it's still one of those things where people are just hearing it differently. But when President Trump said, not having our steel produced in America is a national security concern, this is how Scandinavia interprets that.
The nearly empty floor is a devastating sight for workers at ADF Group.
And there's a kicker in this, too.
The Quebec-based steel producer has laid off 50 employees and is operating on a reduced schedule because of the...
By the way, I didn't know that steel companies were like family businesses.
Used to be.
Is it to produce steel or to cut it up, or what are they doing?
Well, all kinds of every one of these little stages that you just mentioned are all can easily be a family business.
Ah, okay.
Generally, the big giant boys are not family.
Yeah, I see
business.
A big smelter and all that. You know, I'm like,
it's possible.
By the way, I saw in the LA Times there's a town for sale, not far from Burning Man, but it's kind of in between the two forests there in California.
Burning Man's in Nevada.
It's near the Nevada border. It's about 2.5 hours drive from L.A., 2.5 hour drive from San Francisco, about 3 hours to Vegas.
It's not 2.5 from L.A.
Okay, well, I just did a Google search, and okay, so maybe it was 3.5. It's within driving distance.
No, it's not 3.5. It has to be at least 8 hours from
L.A.
Oh,
no. Now, whatever this was, it doesn't matter. It's an old mining town with like eight structures, and it's for sale.
What do they want for it?
$950,000.
Not bad. We can do that. And then get all the No Agenda people. We can put it together, yes, a fund.
Yeah,
just need 10% down.
Yeah, we just do a GoFundMe. It's the mine is still there. You know, I think it was
probably toxic as hell.
Copper,
I'm sure, the
mine. Well, that's where we put the servers.
Oh yeah,
that's the data center, and and we have a dude named Ben Camp.
Ooh,
right.
Yeah, right.
We could put an airstrip
in.
We
saved the world.
Yeah, we could put an airstrip in. Anyway, back to Scandinavian steel.
Trade dispute with the United States.
Well, currently the shop is, I'd say, slower than slow.
James Piscini is the plant manager of the family-run business. And here, the sting of U.S. tariffs landed a deep blow. The Trump administration says the measure is a way to protect American national security. And that hurts, given the type of work ADF Group has been a part of. This Canadian company produced the majority of the steel used for the outer structure and full antenna of the new World Trade Center, a symbol of American perseverance in the heart of Donald Trump's beloved New York City.
Being labeled now as a national security threat, it makes no sense. To us, it makes no sense. We feel kind of flustered. We feel kind of betrayed about that.
It isn't all bad news here. Despite the uncertainty, ADF Group has landed a new U.S. contract, which will increase hours starting in September. Piscini is hoping it will also increase morale on the floor while the trade dispute drags on.
Canada has already filed a challenge with the WTO over U.S. steel and aluminum tariffs. Donald Trump, though, has made no secret of his distaste for the WTO, and he's found an interesting way to destabilize it. destabilizing it by blocking judicial appointments at its appellate body. That's a kind of Supreme Court for world trade disputes. It's supposed to be made up of 7 judges. It's currently down to 4, with another due to leave in September. And if it drops below 3 judges, it can no longer function and can't referee all those complaints about U.S. tariffs.
I didn't know that about the WTO and its appellate board.
I didn't know that
That's interesting.
And decision making with only 3, but okay.
Well, but that's the point. It's like the Trump administration is blocking, kind of like, you know, like I'm sure that it was said that way. Like, oh, this is Supreme Court of the World Trade Organization, and the United States is blocking new candidates so that it just starts to whittle down, and then eventually it's completely ineffective. But no one's talking about that here. I hadn't heard that at all.
No, I've never heard anything about that.
But you heard in the clip, you heard the guy saying, I can't believe, you know, what, we're a national security threat? Here's a soccer mom.
I stood beside the prime minister when he made those statements, and they were strong statements, because I think what it's important for Americans to understand is the justification under your rules for the imposition of these tariffs was a national security consideration. Mm-hmm. So what you are saying to us and to all of your NATO allies is that we somehow represent a national security threat to the United States. And I would just say to all of Canada's American friends, and there are so many, seriously? Do you really believe that Canada, that your NATO allies represent a national security threat to you? And that's why the Prime Minister said it is, frankly, insulting. When Ronald Reagan visited Canada in the 1980s, he said, we are more than friends and neighbors and allies. We are kin, who together have built the most productive relationship between any two countries in the world.
So I'd like our Scandinavian producers to send me some clips where someone explains this properly up there.
I'd like to find someone to send a clip where it said Canada is a national security risk or any of these companies are a national security risk. That's not what he said.
No, of course not.
He said the fact that we need steelmaking capabilities within our own country and not having it is a national security risk, which is what he's talking about.
Yes.
And it was pretty clear to me when he said it.
To me, too.
And it was mostly about the you know, the fact that we have this huge multi-trillion dollar deficit. That was the real national security risk he was talking about consistently.
Yeah.
And it is, because if that folds, we lose the dollar as a reserve currency, and we don't, you know, well, that's not going to happen. Let's face reality. But, you know, it's possible, and under some circumstances, something bad could happen. And you'd have a world economic collapse, and everybody wants their money, which is not going to happen either. I mean, there could be a collapse, but the money thing's not going to happen. But I'm just saying, but theoretically, it's a national security risk.
Yeah.
But no. The Canadians, oh, it's about us. And the Canadians have stopped giving us money, by the way. We got one Albertan that helped us on today's show, and that was it.
Yeah, well, it's blowback. Thanks, Trump.
Yeah, Trump is killing the show.
I'm telling you, it matters. It really does. When stuff like that gets out that way, I understand it. Like, those damn Yanks. Screw those guys. Calling us national security threats.
Yeah, nobody. I mean, it's just not. It's bull. They're lying. It's lies.
I got a funny public service announcement from the Canadian Border Services.
Cannabis and products containing cannabis may soon be illegal in Canada. But that doesn't mean you'll be able to cross the border with them. Whether you use it medically or recreationally, if you're leaving Canada, returning, or visiting, it will still be illegal to take cannabis across the Canadian border. If you have it with you, declare it.
Smoke it!
Moving cannabis across an international border will remain a serious offense that can impact your future.
Yeah.
Keep it legal. Don't bring it in. Don't take it out.
Smoke it now.
I didn't put a clip in here for the Canadian cannabis thing unless we played it in the last show.
You had a clip?
I did, but it was on the last list of clips. I don't think it's on this.
I can take a look if that helps.
Legalized pot in Canada would be the name of the clip.
Oh, okay. Well, let me search for it that way. That's easier. Legalize. Let's see. Legalize pot in Canada. Let's play.
Canada has become only the second nation in the world to legalize.
We played that. Yeah, I think we played that a lot, actually.
Okay, we have a what's the top story in the Bay Area? We're talking about housing. We're talking about a bunch of different things, right?
Yeah.
No, wrong.
you set me up. I have the clip.
Your top story: communities on edge because of a naked man lurking in neighborhoods. He's even broken into one home. Now he's been caught on surveillance video, and within the past few minutes, we've learned of another city where he may have struck. NBC Bay Area's Marianne Favreau is live in Fremont, where the man was last seen. Marianne.
Well, I can tell you that this man strikes at night. Police say he has been spotted here in Fremont four times in the last month. The most brazen attempt was just last month here on the street, where the man entered a home in the middle of the night and then stood naked at the bedroom door of a young woman. Police believe you'll recognize the man shown in this surveillance image, crouching on the doorstep of a home in Pleasanton Thursday. Investigators believe he's the same man who entered the back door of a home here on Andromeda Circle in Fremont last month and performed lewd acts at the bedroom door of an 18-year-old. She screamed. He took off.
I was surprised. I wonder why he had picked that house.
This story, by the way, I cut it there because it went on for 5 minutes about all his other. He apparently goes around. He's found in backyards. He's naked, and he's apparently jerking off everywhere.
Oh, well, they didn't mention that in the report.
They kind of hinted at it. Lewd acts. What else is he doing? And then he's standing at the door there, and you know, jerking off, and this girl screams, and he runs away. Some local pervert that's lost control.
How is Louis C.K. doing these days? Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. I do have a nice social justice warrior moment here. What do we put under social justice? Cultural appropriation. That's the one. That's one of my favorites. Everything is cultural. Saying woke is now cultural appropriation.
Oh. Well, I'm not going to say it. I'm not going to say it anymore.
That you can't say it. You, I'm not saying you, it. Straight guy, straight white guy. You can't say
straight
that.
White guy.
No.
Cisgendered.
Cis. Yeah.
Concerns about cultural appropriation and access aren't confined to film or even Hollywood. Today, the Montreal Jazz Festival canceled one of its high-profile shows. Slave has been the subject of protests in recent days. Its acclaimed director is white, that's Robert Lepage, and it featured a white singer singing songs written by black slaves. This comes a day after prominent U.S. singer-songwriter Moses Sumney canceled performances at the festival over his concerns about Slave.
It's going a bit far now, isn't it?
Oh, man, they're just anything.
So you can't
they're out of control. So these guys are unhinged.
I mean... So you can't even do a cover version anymore of like a Michael Jackson song or something? Because that would be cultural appropriation.
Yeah, it would be bad.
Yeah, and it's jazz, baby. It's supposed to be completely free. And the whole concept of jazz is multiple instruments and things flowing together to create this harmonious on-the-fly masterpiece. No.
Living in the past, dude.
Right, bro. But the story that got no traction... Surprising.
I have another story that's got no traction after your story that's got no traction. It's kind of interesting.
This is not a clip. It's to discuss briefly.
No.
Headline, Al-Shabaab Terror Group Bans Single-Use Plastic Bags. I felt this was... This is headliner stuff.
Yes. Where was the reporting on this?
This was
at least as good as the naked guy roaming around.
Yeah. This is Sky News. It says the Somali militant Islamist group, which has links to Al-Qaeda... has long had an interest in environmental issues.
Sure they have.
I've never read that. It made the official announcement on Radio Andalus, which is operated by Al-Shabaab. Jubaland regional leader Mohammed Abu Abdullah said the group had come to the decision due to the serious threat posed by plastic bags to both humans and livestock. These are the guys that take the girls?
Yeah. Huh. Yeah, rapers.
He added that pollution caused by plastic was damaging to the environment. In the same announcement, the group said it has banned the logging of rare trees. Details of how the eco-friendly bans would be enforced were not shared with listeners. You would cut your head off. Last year, it gets better, Taliban leader Hibatullah Akhundzada claimed Afghans should plant more trees because of their important role in environmental protection, economic development, and beautification of the earth. I mean, did you know this was going on? This consciousness?
Global warming memes are next with these guys.
It's
bull crap.
It's well, maybe it isn't. I mean, I will say that a lot of these terror groups, if you look at the Taliban, they organize their communities. You know, they're organizing it through rather incompatible values to our Western society, but they are organizing. But this is a complete Western thing that they're now bringing in here. Yeah. I mean, what's next?
I don't know. I can't think of anything offhand.
Well,
hemp t-shirts is the only thing I can think of.
I agree. I mean, it's as good as the naked guy running around.
Now, the report that isn't being reported is that as we speak, there are these outrageous riots going on in parts of France, mm-hmm. namely Nantes.
Yeah.
And Nantes has been under riot conditions for the last 4 days.
Angry youth.
No, you can play it. I couldn't find any good clips. They didn't have any clips on France 24. They had no clips on the BBC. So I found some obscure newsletter that had somebody there doing it. And so it's a real lame but accurate clip.
Angry youths burnt confronted police in poor neighborhoods of the French city of Nantes. The violence came after police shot dead a young man who'd been stopped in his car for a traffic violation. Police reports say he refused to cooperate with them and then hit one of their officers, likely injuring him as he tried to drive off. It was then that he was shot. The local law courts in Dervalier neighborhood were also set on fire. Police now say they expect more unrest. Tensions in poor migrant neighborhoods have frequently escalated into clashes with the police in France. In 2005, dozens of cars were torched in similar unrest in Paris, in its outer suburbs where most migrants live. Nantes public prosecutor later revealed that the man had been wanted for a year for organized robbery, concealment, and criminal association.
La police, puis la justice.
The police and the justice system need to act independently to clarify what happened this evening.
Sur ce qui s'est passé ce soir.
Where is Nantes?
Nantes is in the Loire Valley. It's kind of the opening of the where the river goes into the ocean. And it's an old town. It's on the coast. Not on the coast. It's inland.
Inland, yeah.
But it's got this beautiful fortification that just goes way back in the 9th century or something.
Uh-huh.
And it's a very picturesque tourist town. I've been there. So when you start a tour of the Loire Valley, that's usually where you start.
Wow.
But probably not so much anymore.
Right. No, but people saw the pictures and went, let's go there.
They bombed and demolished the courthouse, which I thought was kind of funny. It was kind of mentioned in the report.
That's insane.
Yeah, but no reports whatsoever in the Western media.
I have a flashback for my last clip for today. One of our producers dug this up, and it's great for two reasons. One, it talks about a topic that we recently discussed on the show. This is from 2008. So this is around the time we started with the show, and maybe our first year. And I believe it is also this clip may be the genesis or the reason for Cheryl Atkinson eventually being forced out of CBS, as this is a CBS News report from 2008. Pay attention to the numbers and the names.
It's not the kind of record anyone wants to break. Reports of serious illnesses and deaths linked to medicine have hit an all-time high. That's according to the Institute for Safe Medication Practices, which has analyzed FDA data for a decade. It recently found that from January to March, there were more than 20,000 reports of serious drug reactions, including over 4,800 deaths. That's not just a little more than usual. It's 38% higher than the previous year. Two drugs are blamed in unusually large numbers: the blood thinner heparin, recalled after contamination was found, and the anti-smoking drug Chantix had more reports than the 10 best-selling brand-name drugs combined.
Take the first step. See your doctor and ask if prescription Chantix is right for you.
The FDA has already warned of psychiatric problems with Chantix and says it will take further action if warranted. Pfizer, which makes Chantix, says benefits outweigh the risks. But the patient safety group says stronger Chantix warnings are needed, and the general trend deserves more attention.
What we know is that over that period of time, we've seen a steady increase in reports of serious injuries and death. And this should be troubling to us.
Another trend, a relatively small number of drugs are blamed for a large number of adverse events. The authors of today's report say there's a lesson. Prescription drugs help millions, but also have risks. And the FDA should do a better job at reducing them.
There you go.
You know, now that you mention it, I think that makes more sense for the reason they got rid of her rather than her, the political stuff.
Exactly.
They put up with a lot of stuff, but you're going after Chantix, one of the major advertisers.
What road?
Yeah. You could be done.
It's a big mistake. Big mistake.
Yeah.
And with that, I'm calling it a show.
You can call it a cab.
Nah, I got enough taxis. I got my Learjet waiting for me today. So I'll skedaddle on out of here. We return on Thursday. I'm sure there will be a lot to deconstruct as the Trump rotation continues. North Korea is secretly going to kill us with their nukes. Be very afraid, people. Especially you, that group over there, LGBTQ. Be afraid. Or visit us on Thursday for another dose of sanity. That's what we try to provide. Coming to you from downtown Austin, Texas, we are in the capital of the Drone Star States. This is FEMA Region 6 on all governmental maps in the 5x9 Cludio in the Common Law Condo. In the morning, everybody, I'm Adam Curry.
And from Northern Silicon Valley, where I don't have all this convoluted explanation of where I'm sitting, but it's a mess. I'm John C. Dvorak.
We return on Thursday. Remember us at Dvorak.org/NA. Until then, adios, mofos. All right, I need one anyway.
El Shabab, ya da 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 da. Donate to No Agenda. They give ushers week after week. Donate to No Agenda. It's a show that's really unique. Donate to No Agenda. Listen to John and Adam speak. Donate to No Agenda. Science is turning into a clique.
Yo, VIP. Let's kick it.
Stop. It's my border you're crossing. ICE is back with a brand new detention. Onto your kids, I'll hold tightly. Pack them in cages daily and nightly.
Will it ever stop?
Yo, I don't know. Open the borders and in they'll flow. Extreme left throwing rocks like vandals. Effigy Trump burning up like a candle.
Chance.
Commercial speaker that dines. Maxine Water calls you all to undermine.
Crazy.
What about Obama? You know he started all that drama. Dimension B, full of zealotry. Old meathead calling it a felony. If there's a problem, they'll never solve it. Check the fake news and 5M revolves it.
I believe completely in the First Amendment and in boobs.
Then I saw her boobs. Now I'm a believer.
Because I like boobs.
The best podcast in the universe.
Mofo.
Dvorak.org/NA.
Oreos are just as addictive as cocaine.